Another Monday night, back in the day show, Sal Amato here, brought to you by DigitalSaviorsChicago.com, where we transfer audio, video, reel-to-reel tapes, mixtapes. You got VHS tapes. It doesn't matter. Whatever you got, we can transfer it. It's 815-556-2685. That's 815-556-2685. We pick up and we deliver. And, you know, stuff like this, man, let me tell you. I just finished a project. These old 8mm, look at this thing. And this is like from 1953, right? And it's a lot of work. And if you got them old videotapes, you got them old movies, even if it's 8mm film, you got it on camcorder, we can pick up, deliver, transfer it all to a digital format. So it'll last a lifetime. All right, there's your promo, DigitalSaviorsChicago.com. All right, so on the Monday night show here, again, we bring in another guest as we talk old school every Monday night about not only their careers, a lot of people who you see in the posts that are on the WBMX group page, the Beat Chicago's website, or the Back in the Day group. And we're on multiple platforms, whether it's Facebook, MeWe, whatever platform these groups exist on, all of them. So wherever you find us from, we're glad to have you aboard every Monday night. And if you miss any of the shows, you can always check out the shows on demand at TheBeatChicago.com. No app required. You can find all the past shows and all the guests that we've had through the past weeks. On Monday nights, you can check them out here. Facebook user, Sal Tyree, WCYC. Oh, my God, yeah. One of the few places back in the day when I was a kid, I actually fell asleep on the air, and Mario Reyes came and woke me up at 3 in the morning. I think it was New Year's Eve. I was passed out on the board, dude. Drooling all over myself. Had to be like New Year's Eve of 85 going in 86. Our guest this week, Tyree Cooper. What's up?
Yo, peace, Sal, peace.
How you doing, man? God, it's finally great to be able to see you like within 3 hours of our time.
I know, right?
Yeah, because for a while you were on the other side of the planet over there. And
yeah, 19 of them young men.
Yeah, how many years were you over there?
19.
19 years, and my God, so you didn't get no pizza, you didn't get no steak sandwiches, no beef, no salad.
Oh, no. First of all, I don't eat beef or no beef, no pork.
Okay.
Still ate pizza.
Yeah, see, they got
pizza there.
Yeah,
well, in fact, they have Sbarro's there.
Oh, okay. I had a friend of mine who loved Sbarro's. He said, "This is the greatest thing ever." And I think, look, dude, I'm just gonna go over here and sit in the parking lot and wait for you to get sick. Oh God. Hey, Boogie's okay. Boogie's
he's brother Boogie. That's been my brother, man, forever.
Yeah.
He's the first DJ that gave me a quote unquote real club job gig at the old Flamingo Disco.
Wow.
He's the first person to put me on. Yeah, Boogie.
You know, now they call them residencies, right, Terry? But back then when we was kids, it was like, hey, I got a job.
Yeah, exactly.
I got a job, and I'm going to get paid. You know, now a lot of these guys, they get paid drink tickets. We actually got paid money, and if we didn't
get money. Boogie spent the till with me that day. Yeah. I was like, fuck, that's cool.
And if we had a job where the owner didn't pay us, chances are we were going to wait for him outside in the parking lot with a baseball bat or something to say, look, it was $35, now it's $150, you know?
And peace to my brother Harv from CYC. He believed in me. I got to give nothing but love for Harv because he believed in my DJing and my mixes, man, where, I really couldn't get no love, and I was trying to break into a different market. And Harv was just like, come on, why at the same time Kenny Jason was like, turn in your mixes now.
Harv's one of the hardest working guys
I've ever met.
And yes, dedicated to the kids, to helping these kids. I mean, when I was at CYC, I got out of broadcasting school, and I think Harv might have got there just a little, maybe 3 hours after me. Not much. And I was there like 84 when I got there.
What a crew,
Tyree.
Sal, man, I had some of the best times.
Yeah.
At CYC, turning my coming from Inglewood and turning my tapes in until I moved to Rogers Park, driving from Rogers Park to turn my tapes in. It was fun, man. It was fucking fun.
You know, when we turned the tapes in at BMX, you know, 81, when Lee really started doing the mixes, you'd have to drop the mixes off you'd have to go up the elevator, and then you had to go up the stairs, and it was like an arc of that you had to wait there. And that was Armando who would come to the back door and pick up your reel-to-reel, and then it was, okay, thank you. It was like top secret. Slam the door on your face, and then they'd go in there. And then as they got to know you, they would let you, you know, get to know you a little bit better. But you were an actual working DJ. You were a club DJ before you did your music stuff, right? Before I did the night.
Yeah. How can I explain it? I started out, my first attempt at DJ was 1982, like my last year in high school. But by the time I graduated, because I was playing basketball pretty much all through high school. I had a little scholarship to the University of Wisconsin Stout to shoot ball. I kind of left that alone and came home, went to Kennedy King. So around 83, 84, I got serious about DJing. And like 2 years later, I was doing my own parties with Mike Dunn and Hugo H. Shout out to my brothers. Again, and been working clubs. Sam Chapman, too. I can't forget Sam Chapman. He's another brother that put me on. I say put me on. Mm-hmm. Young man, I'm going to put you in this party, and you got to handle it. And, you know, did it that way. Another promoter, Marvin Terry, he's the first person to put me out there, like to bring me out, period. Mm-hmm. Just like, hello, world. This is Tyree Cooper, so to speak. Well, at that time, my name was Tyree Music Mixing Cooper. Then I changed it to Tyree Jackmaster House.
You know, do you ever lose track? It's like, what am I today? Let me see. What did they say? And anyway, here's the best part, Tyree. None of them flyers, ain't nobody never spelled nothing right. Nobody proofread shit. I saw a guy, Mario Reyes was once Marisol Reality. Nobody proofed nothing, and it didn't matter. Nobody cared. Kind of like Facebook today. Don't nobody proof nothing. They just, whatever it is, it is.
I got one time someone said something to me, and it was Farley. It was back in the day when he saw my name, Jackmaster House. He was like, "Damn, man, I can't be the only Jackmaster, man." I said, "Man, you're the Jackmaster of funk. I'm the Jackmaster of house." But damn, man, really?
Oh God, the arguments and the feelings that got hurt over those words, man.
Yeah, and after that, I was like, you know what? I'm Tyree Cooper. Yeah. He's right. Farley's right. I'm Tyree Cooper, and I've been that ever since. But yeah, I've been DJing since 80. As a club DJ, let's say 85, like 80, late 84, 85.
You know what? It's in 84. How much do you remember of 1984?
How much I try not to remember 1984?
Yeah. Well, I mean, naturally, there's just stuff you're going to bury. You ain't ever
going to bury. Oh, man. Dude, I remember a lot of 84. I remember giving the coach my uniform, telling him I'm quitting the basketball team.
You had a scholarship. Yeah, you were good. I was just, yeah, but when I was playing basketball, I was just there because I read dirty books to the team and I motivated them. You were there because you were good. Yeah.
Yeah.
Big difference. Yeah, when I was at Whitney Young, they looked at me like, why is he here? Well, he reads. He's got these really cool books.
Now, I was real decent. I just told the coach in 1984, the coach asked me because I kept missing practice because I was hanging out at WKKC with Hugo H, Lil John, George Little, Greg Winfield. All the Friday night, Brian Fraser, all these the Friday night audio crew, right? Mm-hmm. And the coach kept saying, "Son, why are you a piece? Fingers, hey, why are you hanging out with these cats in the radio station?" I'm like, "Man, I'm thinking about doing this." And he was like, "Son, you're gonna throw your life away. I can help you with your." I'm like, "Yo, dude, I'm pretty much done with basketball. Mm-hmm. I'm not going to the NBA as much as I like to believe. Mm-hmm. I'm 5'6". I wear about $135 soaking wet. Man, ain't no way in the world. I got my cousin Ricky Bradshaw. Peace, Rick. I'm $135 soaking wet. Man, I'm not going no dog on NBA. Man, I'm gonna go up here and hang out with these brothers at the radio station. And that was 84. I got introduced. I lied on the radio. Me and Hugo lied. This is all 1984. Aladdin 1984 that I was Jesse Saunders and Hugo was Farley, and we was on WKKC cracking jokes. I remember when Friday Night Audio got put together. I hung out with them. Also in 1984, I was DJing on WNUR radio station with Prince Easy Lee, Larry Ladd, T-Shop Lee, Meredith, DJ Sweet D, Meredith was his name. E Smooth, Eric Miller. We were both on it. That's how I met him. Was in 1984.
When he had Love Tribe, I remember we got Love Tribe added all over the place back then. And it was, but that was 96, right?
Yeah, that was 90. But
as 96, and I put some of them pictures up, Tyree, of him and the girls back then. I'm like, man, where the hell you find that picture? So I took it. Remember me? I'm the one who got you like 50 ads on this song.
Right.
Hey, look who jumped in here. Man, look who jumped in. Chris Jen.
Oh, that's my brother right there. My other brother right there. What's up, Chris?
Yeah.
Oh, Chris got me into, Chris really, really, really got me into rock and roll.
He was a rocker. I was so anti-hippie music.
Wait. He wasn't just a rocker.
I know.
Oh, Chris is a bad motherfucker. Chris could play drums, bro.
Yeah.
We was in a band. Chris and I was in a band together. Chris. Chris is a bad drummer. don't let that brother fool you. Yeah. And a DJ, a great DJ. But we used to be roommates. Chris and I used to be roommates up in Rogers Park.
Mm-hmm.
had no money, but the greatest of times and the best of music. Oh, that's my brother forever. He knows my daughter still is in love with her Uncle Chris. The moment I mentioned his name, I talked to Uncle Chris. Did you really? Yeah, that's family. Chris is family. Sorry about that.
I haven't seen Chris in a long time. And, you know, I get a lot of memories, especially when I had Modern Tracks. Chris was working with me. We were developing a system
for
all the labels, all the pools, to be able to talk to each other, including the artists. It was a huge, huge project. I think I probably had about 22, 23 Gs into it. And then we let the whole thing go and promo only bought the company about a year later. But it was a way, you know, because we were thinking on levels, especially because Chris came from that pool site, you know.
Yes, he did.
And, you know, anybody who ran a record pool back in the day, they were serious about their pool, man. They were serious about a lot of DJs were not who were in the pool. I don't care what anybody says. And, you know, they tell you, a lot of these guys just take their shit seriously. You take that, and he took it seriously.
You better have your top 10 list when you get your records from Chris. He wasn't playing. Hey, yo, I'm not giving you no records. Ty, where's your, come on, Chris. Hey, Ty, where is it?
How hard is it to put the, you know, remember you had to do your feedback sheet. How hard is it to do the feedback, right? Especially if you're a label like you, Ty, you got a record and you want to know what people are saying. You spent that money out of your pocket as an artist, or the label did. And they took it out of you and put you in perpetual recoup. So you'd at least like to know what the hell's going on with your record, right?
Exactly. At least you want to know, because if you're getting screwed out your bag, then you definitely want to know what somebody said about your record. Did anybody say something about the money?
Yeah, let's talk about I Fear the Night, Tyree, because you had that and you had it on a cassette, right? And then you went to a couple labels and explain how the whole thing came to be.
Okay. I'm gonna go through it fast. Okay, so you got me up there. Right on.
That's your SoundCloud. Yeah.
Right. So what happened was Marshall Jefferson lived around the corner from the club where Mike Dunn, Hugo and myself was playing at. And Marshall said to us, can he bring his equipment to the club? And we all looked at each other like, are you fucking kidding me? Hell yeah, you can bring that shit to the club.
Mm-hmm.
So he brought a 48 track mixing board Ivanized Ivanized rack mounts. He brought his whole studio at from the house to his house, to the studio to the club. So
my God,
707, 727, 808 Right. So we was like, which drum machine you're not using?
Mm-hmm.
He was like, I'm not using the 808. So Mike Dunn, myself, and Hugo say, hey man, look, we give you $20. Can we borrow your drum machine for a week? He said, yeah, I'm not using it. I'm just going in the studio to do the Jungle Ones. Hey, can we have it on tape? Sure, you can have it on tape. It wasn't a matter of fact, take this and Time Marches On. We was like, okay. Okay. We borrowed his drum machine and we did the beats. Mike Dunn, myself, and Hugo, because I don't want it to be twisted. Like, man, I did that with... Anyway, we did the beats. So I took it. I took a cassette. I had a cassette. I was trying to shop it around. Went to Larry Sherman. He said it was a piece of shit. This dude up on 87th and Racine, Hollywood Records. It was a small little record store, but he had just started a record label. He didn't like it. He wanted more instrumentation or whatever. So I took it to Rocky, or took it to Benji. And because I went down there to get free records, in all honesty. That was my whole goal. I lied to Benji and said, yeah, I was the top DJ on the South Side. I'm on this radio station. I'm the number one, da-da-da-da-da.
Were they at Halsted by then, Tyree? Was he at Halsted Street yet?
No, this is the Halsted, right? 1134 West Chicago Avenue.
Yeah, yeah.
Yes, Audio Talent then, right? And so I went down there, and Rocky heard it. The original song was like, it was on a half-hour cassette. So half the cassette, so 15 minutes of the song was I Fit, 15 minutes of the cassette was I Fit at Night. Mm-hmm. Rocky played it 5 times. In my presence. So I had to sit there for as long as he played it. Then he said, you know, it needs strings. I think it needs strings. I'm sure it needs strings. I'm like, Rock, this doesn't need strings. So he said, go to Marshall and ask Marshall to help you. So I went to Marshall. He said, for sure, where's my drum machine? I went, yeah, okay, I'll give it to you. But let me record this record first. So I'm asking Hugo and Mike Dunn, which pattern number did we use? Both of them caught quick amnesia. Mm-hmm. I don't know. I just said they caught amnesia.
Mm-hmm.
But so I had this Benji sat there and watched me in studio time. You know, studio time was expensive.
Back yeah, and it came out of your pocket once you signed that deal.
Man, look, it took me. I sat there and thought what we did at the club was I Fit at Night. I got close as I could because Rocky was like, Rocky and Benji was like, dude, are you ready? I'm like, yeah, I'm almost ready. So I just like, fuck it. And threw it together. And there you have I Fit at Night. Rocky did the original mix. He'd tell you that he didn't. No, he moved me out the way.
Off the board.
Yep, and sat at the board. Once he did the first mix and he was like, I guess he was like, shit, this shit is offbeat. You do the next one. And this is my first time behind an actual mixing board. So mm-hmm. I'm like, I need more bass. I need more kick drum because I'm drawn into this kick drum sound, this 808 coming through the speaker. So that's why I feel that it was boom, 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 boom. And I did the B side. Didn't make it that much better, but to me it was better than the A side. And that's how After the Night came out.
Were there any versions that you did, Tyree, that never got released, or versions you did that just sat on tape and never got mastered?
The only one that I know of is the original cassette that, from my understanding, is still floating around in certain DJs' crates.
Really?
Yeah, in their CDs or whatever. Because I gave a copy of it to Lil Lewis.
Mm-hmm.
But just the original version. When it came to the vinyl, there is no other version. I think Ruby Red did an edit of the original, and they released it as a license. They released it. They did a license deal. Rocky Ladd said, "Oh, I don't know how they got it." They did it as a license. They did like they did an edit of it. But other than that, no, there's no other. no other versions of that song. And we did it at where Larry Sturm was. What was that?
Tanglewood.
Tanglewood, the original Tanglewood, or 707 Green or some shit like that.
Yep, yep. Yeah, that was, wow, was about 100 pounds ago. Yeah. You know, somebody here mentioned Benji, you know, and we were talking on Benji. Yeah. God bless his soul, man.
Yeah, that was my mentor. Big brother, mentor.
Yeah.
He taught me this business.
Yeah, and he, I mean, when it came, he was 100% dedicated at Quantum. He was 100% dedicated with the label. Whether it was Underground or DJ International, no matter which one of those labels.
Yeah.
I remember I knew Benji. I mean, you knew him. I had known him when he worked at Baby O's with Ralphie. Ralphie and him working at Baby O's. And, and then he would come to the clubs I was working in. He's like, dude, you play this kind of music? And I looked at him and said, just give me the damn record. You know, it was like an acetate. You throw it on the turntable, go, okay, yeah, 120 beats per minute, perfect. Right into the song. And Benji knew, I mean, he knew, eventually he fine-tuned it. He knew what you were going to play and what you weren't going to play. And he would pull that out of his backpack. He always had the backpack with records, no matter where he went. And when he brought I Fear the Night, I think, to be honest with you, I think he was still at Baby Oak.
He was between Baby O. He had just started Quantum.
Yeah.
He was still at Baby O and DJ International at the same time.
Yeah, because I remember him getting me and giving me a copy. And then I have a faint recollection of going to Baby O's to buy another copy. You know, because back then you needed two copies of everything. Now, you know,
right.
Now you got the computer to give you, you know, all the copies you want. Now, when you did I Fear the Night, did you intend it to be that raw? Did you have that in your ear? You just wanted it that raw, just the drum and Sheik's vocal like that? Or were there any other ideas floating around in your head to lay a bass line into it or something?
Okay, when Rocky asked me to put some strings on, he also asked me to come up with a bass line. Mm-hmm. Marshall and I couldn't think of a bass line to save our life. So I just basically got... And for Marshall's house, I picked up unreleased tracks from Marshall on cassette. And when we got to the studio, Rocky asked me if I could play a bass line. I'm like, nah. Because I didn't want nobody to touch it because I really wanted it. My whole idea for I Fear the Night was like this this track from the Power Plant. It was called the Power Plant theme. It was just drums, Adrian Jett singing. Ah, what's that go? Because she was singing, she's the original vocalist, I think, the original vocalist for Your Love. Because when I heard Your Love, I heard it with her first, and then Jamie came later, right?
Which song was it again?
Your Love.
No, the one out of Power Plant.
It's called a Power Plant theme, but it was the original Your Love. That's what I'm saying.
Oh, okay, gotcha.
The original vocal, how about this? The original vocals from Your Love with the Power Plant with this drum beat, this amazing drum beat under it. The hi-hats, all this shit jumping off. I'm like, hey, I want a track like that, but how do I get it to go, ah? I said, I can't do that. That's somebody else's song. I was like, chick.
Go ahead. I'm going to kick it. Go ahead.
I said, chick. I said, chick, that's my sister, Chick. Everybody call her Sheik. It's Chick.
No kidding. Well, slap me in the ass. Okay.
Yeah. I said, Chick, can you do this? I Fear the Night. She said, yeah, what else is going to go with it? I don't know. Write something. So she sat and wrote the lyrics to I Fear the Night. When I'm walking through the park late in the dark, how'd that sound? Yeah, that's good. Come on, finish. So when she sang it and we sang the demo in the club, mind you, in the DJ booth, mind you, I took it, like I said, I took it to different DJs, took it to Lil Lewis. Larry Sherman thought it was a piece of shit. Hollywood Records didn't like it, really. So I thought it was going to be thrown away. Benji was like, hey, man, this is pretty cool. I'm like, oh, okay. What are you going to do? I was like, I don't know. What do you want me to do? So we mixed it and it came out. I'm thinking, okay, nobody's going to play this. because at that time it was, you know, the radio was it sounded a little bit, my record was too raw for radio. Then that same night, what piece, Candy? The same day I'm thinking about it, I hear Ralphie Rosario play it first. I'm like, oh snap. Mm-hmm. Ralphie played my record first. I'm like, wait, Ralphie played it first, not Farley? Oh hell no, that's bugged out. Mm-hmm. So, Ralphie was the first person to play out for the night, and it's been a wrap for me ever since, as far as major radio.
Well, the track, I mean, was just, it was a no-brainer because it was banging about right around 122, right? 124?
122.
Yeah, so, I mean, once that thing kicked, and, you know, you had a lot of the early house stuff that was really raw, so if you were playing that, it was always a great track to work your way out of as well, because mm-hmm. she didn't have any, other than her vocals, any key changes to worry about going out of the song, you know what I mean? So you can underline, when you're mixing, you can underline a great bass line, a synth sample, even like Your Love, you had all the, it had so many possibilities as a DJ that you looked for when you wanted to either go with a different flow coming out of it, but that banging, man, that pounding, that, and it was very haunting. And look, her vocals were perfect because
I did.
It was haunting, and it was just the beat track and that haunting vocal, and boom, right out, and it kept the floor going. That's for sure. I never had issues with the song, ever. When it came, actually, none of your, there wasn't one of your songs I ever had an issue with ever.
Oh no, I've heard, like especially like I Fit at Night.
Mm-hmm.
Hey man, like Julian used to ride me. Hey man, the count is off. The count is. I'm like, the fuck count are you talking about? What count you talking about? I'm a Southside DJ, bro. That shit is on. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. You're in. What else more? What more do you need? Yeah, it took the art of learning how to DJ to understand what he was talking about. I heard a lot of that. And speaking of I Fit at Night, even back in the day, right, Sal? Like today, you can go and DJ somewhere, and they consider that, you know, you doing something live. Like this is something that you present. Back in the day, if you made a record, and if it was a hot record, like, I don't know, like Love Can't Turn Around, I Fit at Night, K Joy's Like This, you had to go and perform that motherfucker. I had to go bring my records for a DJ set. So I had to give a shout out to another person that's in this room now who schooled me on live performance, and that's Candy J.
Mm-hmm.
She made sure, I ain't gonna say made sure, but she definitely made me understand what a live show was, to the point where when the hip house stuff came, I was into a live show then. I knew exactly what Candy was talking about because I had watched her talk to me about what to do during, you know, how to prepare for the live show. Mm-hmm. You know, you need this, you need that. You need this, you gotta have a stage presence. Tyree, what are you gonna do? What are you gonna do? And I'm looking at Candy like a deer in headlights, like, what you talking about, Willis? The fuck? What are you talking about, Candy? So we got on stage at La Mirage, man. That was my first time doing it.
Wow.
La Mirage, first time after Candy's tutelage doing it. Then she took me on the road with her and did a couple shows with her. So, and I don't know if nobody knows, but Candy J used to put on a hell of a show. I can't front or whatever, but she put on a hell of a fucking show back.
Well, yeah, when you put on a show and you're doing a live show, you go, yeah, you came from that DJ side. And I, you know, the one thing was, like, when you look at early JM Silk videos.
Ooh, another one. Oh, my
God. You know, when you look at, you know, guys, and look, even Byron puts out, it's like, dude, it's a show.
Yes.
It's not just, you're an entertainer, man. It's not just about that track. You still got to entertain people.
Daryl Pandy, too, bro.
Oh, well, he was so, Daryl was so animated that he was a show in itself. You know what I mean?
Really,
1 minute he's on the stage, next minute he might be sitting, you know, shaking you, screaming, you know, that's the show. But damn, there's so much entertainment than just singing, you know?
I didn't understand. Again, Sal, I just thought you just go on there, and you know, I was so used to seeing like Run DMC, yo, you know, all that stuff. She like, I know she wanted to say, little boy, if you don't get that shit the fuck up out of here, this is how you do a show. And again, she schooled me. And by the time the hip house came around, and I was well into how to put together a show, I was into it then. I'm like, oh, yeah, I got my dances, routine, you know, just stage presence. I'm going to be over here. Y'all be over there. We're going to do this at this time of the show and this, that, and the third. So my show for 20 minutes, 25 minutes was pure energy. Mm-hmm. It was pure energy. Well, 20 minutes was pure energy.
You know, I'm looking here, and you know, when you were talking, when you mentioned Run DMC, and Boogie had mentioned something earlier. Here it is. This is actually the only track that Benji was ever on, right? This Cool House track, the Rock This Party, right? Benji's. I mean, I'm going to pull this up. Hang on for a second. I'm just going to pull it up. You'll hear it too. This is where you were trying to sound like a little Run DMC over here. You got the intro. Benji will be coming. There he is.
Yeah, Crew House.
Yeah.
Oh my goodness. Oh yeah. Man.
Some good memories there, my
friend. Oh, man, Boogie. That was done down at the old studio in DJ International in the basement. Oh, really? Man. Yeah, man. Me and Boogie, we did like two or three songs, but that was the first one. We just had fun, man. Boogie and I always had fun. Like I said, that's my other brother right there. That's my brother.
Let's take a look at what Resident Advisor. Is this Resident Advisor? Yeah.
Yep, it's Resident Advisor.
Got to update. Get that bio updated. You're not in Berlin anymore.
Yeah, I know. But I keep it like that. So, you know, my whole bio has to be updated because it says as of 2014.
Yeah, God, it hasn't been updated in a while, huh?
Yeah, you know.
Yeah.
Yeah,
hey, let me ask you about Resident Advisor. You get to update it or do they update it or do you got to send it to them and they change it? How's Resident Advisor work for you?
I imagine I have to update it because if you're not that big on Resident Advisor, I'm going to throw some hate juice. If you're not one of their main, like one of their artists they click with, they don't give two shits about you.
Yeah.
I don't mean just me. I'm talking about like Chicago house in general.
Yeah.
In general. So, you know, they don't care. So I have to do that. I have to edit it myself, which I should have done, but I just left it alone.
At least it comes from you. It's, you know, whereas in certain sites, they make up the history. And you look at your history and go, the hell are you talking about? I worked at a hot dog stand, you know? What?
Yeah. Oh, yeah, right? I didn't even put down that I delivered pizza and shit in my rebellion against the music industry and shit, right? When I said fuck the music industry, I quit.
Yeah, you know, I just did that with acting. I'm at the point I'm not chasing a dream. I never was. And I'm so fed up with our union, with SAG. I've had two or three calls for projects. I'm like, no, thanks. I'm good. I'm done. If 98% of our members don't qualify for health care under the union, but the ones making $60 million a year off of residuals qualify. Okay. So if you care so much about the working people, now how come them 2% ain't paying for their own health care? Kiss my ass with half the pedophiles and freaks that run half the industry. I don't want anything to do with it anymore. So
I don't see freaks. But I did see it a few movies, but they are some freaks in the music in the industry. Yeah, that's
everywhere.
True.
Everywhere. It don't matter where you go. There's a lot of people who probably came through who should have never. You know, I don't hold things back, you know me.
No, yeah, trust me, sir, I never did, bro.
I am holding back a lot right now. Hey, this Jamie Principle, this one's an unreleased version. Check this
out. That's what I'm talking about.
Go ahead.
No, that's the one I'm talking about. Where I right.
Look at that, 22,000 views. That's it. Should be more.
Right there.
Yep. You can just see all the fog and the lights behind them.
Yeah, but I fear the night is where I got that from.
Yeah.
And that's the version of your love that no one really knows.
Yeah. That's great stuff, man. And then where to go? Oh, here we go. Let me pull this up. So when you're working on that, Tyree, did you wind up working overnight? Did you eat anything good? Did they feed you at least? Throw some food at you? Something nice when you were in the studio? That was always important to me when I was working. I had to have a good meal.
He gave me and my sister two choices. A pizza with spinach, which I thought was the nastiest shit on the planet, which is not bad. And a pizza with cheese. And plenty of Pepsi and Coca-Cola to drink. That's what he gave us in the studio. And then...
Did he charge you for it on the back end for the advance or no?
Everything, bro. And then, Sal, wait. Then there was this magazine, right? The Enemy, the New Music Express.
Yeah.
And I'm like, because my friend Armand Ransom, Professor Funk, right? Because Professor Funk was on the cover of it, and it was all about this new music genre called house music, and he had. Professor Funk had this crown on his head, and you know he had this stoic look, like you know he's very you know very stoic. And the article read, "So how much do these records cost in the studio?" He said, "Rocky said, and I quote: some tracks vary, but records like I Fit a Night only cost about $50."
And then you're looking at your quarterly going. It cost $50, but I got $36,000 in recoup. Okay.
Dude, I didn't even get that. I didn't get no statement until the first 3 years of me being on that label.
Really? Wow.
I used to ask for one. I'm not saying I was a smarty pants, but you know, you talk to older heads that's been in the music business and they tell you certain things that, you know, are supposed to go on. So when I asked them for like royalty statements, you know, he laughed it off and either.
Where'd you hear that from? Who told you about that?
Right. It was kind of those kind of things like, huh, oh, Tyree, we overpaid you.
Yeah.
Now you overpay me. I don't know what I sold. Oh, well, you know, this business is they, you know, we don't know. I think I sold 15,000. Oh, how you know you sold 15,000? Who told you that? I said, because they played the record on the radio all the time. Oh, that doesn't mean anything. So I got that. And that, let me see, I was 86. My first statement was in 1988 was my first statement from DJ International. And of course, they didn't give me no money. They said they paid me everything up until that point.
Wow. Well, yeah, I'm still chasing my royalties from Bad Boys, and I shot that in 1982. So I'm still chasing royalties for that movie.
You mean from the movie with what's my man name? Sean Penn.
Yeah, Sean Penn. Isai Morales.
Isai Morales. Yeah.
And Eric Gurry. I still talk to Eric. He played Horowitz. I still talk to him, and we
okay.
But I'm still chasing them for money. So I get it. You're chasing your money.
Wow, you still chasing royalties for that? Well, I'm not chasing royalties no more with Rocky. No, I'm
dead. The union's useless. My union's useless. 38 years. I'm still chasing my money from that.
No, so, I did one better than that. I got a lawyer and it's like, you know, enough is enough.
Yeah. You got a body of work here, bro. I mean, I fear that I ain't the only thing you ever done. So which we're going to get to, of course, but you got a body of work, and then here's a question. There's two videos floating out there of Turn Up the Bass. There's the video of you, and then there's the one before we get to that. Somebody wants to know, who did the laugh on I Fear the Night? Sorry,
Rocky Jones.
Oh, is that Rocky?
Yep, and I did I Fear the Night. That's me with the whisper.
Okay, cool. So there you go. We answered the question. You're welcome. $10 in the jar. Thank you. All right. Now, where was I? Oh, so Cool Rock. I mean, when you Turn Up the Bass, how'd you?
Okay.
Lay out the foundations and Turn Up the Bass going from just you and then Cool Rock.
Okay. So I used to be a, I don't know if anyone knows what a studio rat is. I was a studio rat because I wasn't making no money. I wasn't making no money selling records with Benji at Quantum Distributors because I worked for Benji. Boogie and I worked for Benji at Quantum. We was making $2.35 an hour, some crazy shit like that.
Was Hazel there too, Tyree?
Hazel had not got there. Yaya had not really got this, but she was just getting there. Mm-hmm. Yaya was just getting there. So this, we talking about 87. So all of 87, I'm in the studio with Rocky, Joe Smooth, and Pete Black, because this was Professor Funk was working there, right? That's right. But still was before, yeah, Boogie, this still before Yaya got there. But anyway, we was Rocky's Funk brothers, right? We did all the, Pete Black and Joe Smooth did all the keyboard works and pretty much every song that Rocky quote unquote produced.
Mm-hmm.
And then my part was, cause up to the suggestion of Benji, hey Ty, you know, you like making those little tracks and stuff. Won't you ask Rocky, you know, give you like $50 a track for every song that he's producing. You can make some money that way. I was like, $50. I mean, you know, you start doing the math. Four songs, that's $200. My rent is $400. If I'm in the studio, I can make my rent in the studio.
Yeah.
So that was just a fine concept that I had in my head because that shit did not pan out. So anyway, doing this whole for the whole year, Fast Eddie came down 1988. And I guess he wanted to do some things with DJ International, but he wanted to do hip hop. And Rocky was like, nope, no hip hop. Excuse me, no hip hop, only house. And Eddie was like, fuck that. I'm not doing no house music. So I guess he said, fuck it, I'll rap over this shit. I'm only paraphrasing what Eddie might have said, knowing Eddie.
Mm-hmm.
I'll rap over this shit. So he did a track, Acid Thunder first. And then next thing I know, he came back with this song, Yo, Yo, Get Funky. He said, hey, Ty, check this out. And I'm listening to this motherfucker. I'm like, my mouth hit the ground. Like, who is that rapping? He's like, stop playing. That's me. No, Ed, seriously, who is that rapping?
Mm-hmm.
He said, that's me. And so Rocky came down, Benji came down, was late. It was all geek. This song is going to be woo-woo-woo. And Benji like, hey, you should do a song like that. Nope, that's Fast Eddie's thing. I do deep house. I like my arrangements, blah, blah, blah. Benji said, hey, man, it could turn out to be the biggest song of your career. Oh, for real? Okay, hold on. Hey, Liddell, what's Kool Rock's number? Yeah, I got a song I want to do with Kool Rock. Now, I met Kool Rock, this is 88, I met Kool Rock in 1985 at a DJ battle up on, Centrum Hall on Ashland, right?
Mm-hmm.
It was a big DJ battle. Who won? It was Tony Estrada, Cesar Echeverria, Tony Badea, Kool Rock Steady, myself.
He made the big.
And a few other, one other, I'm missing somebody. Please don't kill me if I'm missing you. But anyway, Tony Estrada, right? So when I asked for Kool Rock's number, I said, yo, hey man, I got a song. I don't know if you're going to do it. He said, let me hear it. So I drove to his house. I brought him a cassette. He heard. He said, yeah, okay, leave it with me. I left it with him. I kid you not. The next day, he said, hey, I got something. So he said the lines. He said the lines over the telephone. I went, damn, all right, you got it? He said, yeah, I got it. So we went to, came down to the studio, recorded it. Benji was just like, hey, Tyree, this is going to be your biggest hit ever. And I'm looking at him like, Benji, this song is way too deep for somebody to like. And he looked at me like, motherfuckers, you crazy. Deep. I'm like, Benji, this song is, he got piano in it. He got, you know, all this stuff jumping off. He's like, bro, I'll be quiet. And he was quiet. So we did the song in September. Yes, Harvey, you hosted that battle. Harvey Roman hosted that battle. So let's say we did that song in September. By November, we were out the country. not just out of Chicago. We was out the country going to London. That's how fast that song had risen. So it went from just an idea from Eric B. and Rakim, turn up the bass. I said, I like to turn up the bass, move it to the crowd. I like to turn the bass when it gets real loud because I like to move the crowd. I was like, I can't take all that shit. That's Rakim. Mm-hmm. But I can take turn up the bass. So I said, hey, guys, let's do me a favor. The engineer, Eddie, and his cousin, I was like, hey, we all going at one time, we're going to say, one, two, three, we're going to say, turn up the bass. It's like, okay, Ty, okay, okay. One, two, three. And all the voice you heard was mine, right? Mm-hmm. I'm like, the fuck?
Why are you here?
Right, like, what? And I said, fuck it, you just leave it. Mm-hmm. And the first mix is the one that after the first mix that I did was the one that I gave to Fast Steady. It's called the Fast Steady Scratch It Up mix, right? That was the very first mix. Because Eddie was just downstairs in the studio, just taking records, blah, and just scratching. Bring the noise. Just on the fly. We just scratch it. One record after the other. I'm like, all right, this is the Fast Steady mix. He was like, fuck it, I don't care. So he didn't do the mix. I just put his name on it. Like he did. I think he may have did an edit. I think. And that's how that record came about.
Yeah, you'll never really know, will you? Let me pull this in here real quick, Terry. Yeah. Let me pull this right here.
Now this right here. This video was done 10 years after the song was released.
So it wasn't my imagination then?
No. Because I did a deal with Epic Records in 1998, 10 years after the song was done, after it was released, 10 years after the song was released. And they wanted to do, I told them that there was never a video for the song. So again, yeah, half my money. My advance went to paying for this actual video.
So you're talking about this video here in the shooting all over the city and in the barbershop and stuff, right?
Yeah, exactly. And that's because the whole thing behind it, and this is my directorial debut, Sal. I kind of directed this whole video.
What'd you shoot it on, Tyree? Where were you shooting at?
8mm, believe it or not.
Really?
No kidding. You know, that's why it's so grainy and shit, right?
Yeah.
That's why it's kind of real grainy. We had the small handheld, the handheld joint.
Yeah. 8mm.
Yep.
Oh, and actually, this is a 16.
No, but it's smaller than. But it's smaller than.
That. Yeah, the 8mm are. Yeah, this is a 16 for a project.
I didn't do the DOP, but I did tell everybody. I did tell them where to go. What I wanted in it, because the concept was, it's 10 years since anyone has seen Tyree Cooper on a major scale. So here's a reporter reporting on that he's seen Tyree Cooper, but he's bouncing around the city of Chicago. I have a cameo shot with Fast Eddie in there, Taco Bops, Tim Baker, Ahim Azadi Adursi, who just passed the other day. Tim Baker is in it. Taco Bops, the two guys that are dancing.
Yeah, I'm gonna hit it here. Hang on. So that's why Cool Rock's not in this video. Right. This is 98. Yeah.
Right. Right.
Good stuff, my friend.
Yeah, I tried to make it as hip house as possible. We got Mel Hammond, Fast Eddie, Tim Baker, Taco Bops, Gramophone. original shot, I had pictures with Joe in it. I didn't know Tim was on CYC. I had pictures with Joe in it. Peace, Mario Reyes. That's my other brother, Mario Reyes, from back in 86.
I got to share a story with you about Mario when you're done. It'll
I'm going to be real quick. I try to make it as hip house as possible, mm-hmm. even down to the fact where the studio at the end of the video is Chicago Tracks, where Vince Lawrence had his own room. And even that shot, right?
Yeah, right here. Yeah, right here.
Yeah, because Vince Lawrence is the one that read the DJ International contract for me. So he's, I can say responsible, but he read the contract where I couldn't afford a lawyer. Mm. He read and interpreted the contract for me, and he gave me some really good words of wisdom. And I was like, I bet. And I signed that motherfucker. I was like, all right, if I can do that, what'd you say? Did I sign it? And so I signed it. And I wanted to make sure I gave love back to Vince Lawrence for helping me out, because he didn't really have to.
Yeah, he's a straight shooter, man. He's a straight shooter.
Yeah, he is.
Not a lot like that, you know. There's not a lot like that.
I know. He you know, because again, if it wasn't for Jesse Saunders, Vince Lawrence, Dwayne Buford, you might not have seen a Tyree Cooper record. Because, again, I lied to those guys and said that I was a big DJ on the South Side because I wanted some free records. Mm-hmm. I was all about free records. I'm forever about free music. And when they allowed me to come down, when Jesse allowed me to come down to his mother's house on the South Side, or his grandmother's house, I'm not sure whose house it was. When he allowed me to come down and I saw this equipment, I went, shit, this is what I want to do. Fuck that. Mm-hmm. I know I'm done with basketball. I know I'm done with basketball. That's right. And a part of it was shot at the Hip House.
Hip House in there.
My brother's right there, too. Yeah. My brother's right there, too. DJ Precise, DMC champion. Yeah. DMC champions.
Yeah, I saw that. I mean, that looks like Hip House in there.
Yeah. That's what we started it at. Because it was a Hip House video. We started it at Hip House. And the character I was portraying was Flint Light 'em Up. I know that means nothing to somebody, but mm-hmm. you need a lighter, right? And Light 'em Up is a reference to weed. So Flint Light 'em Up. Tim Baker was the cable dude. And that was pretty much it. Yeah, that was pretty much it.
Talk about TC Crew here, because Chris, you know, Chris brought it up, and it's something we don't really, and a lot of people don't hear over here, you know. But it really was. I mean, you had some tracks there, dude, that were.
Yeah. The TC Crew started out with. The TC Crew started out as a very underground movement, like the music industry was changing and. DJ International really wasn't changing the way the industry was changing, because like Strictly Rhythm was the hot new business.
And they had Rob and Andy doing over Strictly Hype before they create, because UC came after Strictly Hype, but they were, you're coming into the 90s, right? Basically.
Yeah, this was the techno 90s, as I called it.
Yeah.
But before that, it was, yeah, the 90s. So like my first two TC Crew releases was just me by myself. So, I ran across a good friend of mine, another great DJ no one gives love to, named DJ Ping, Steve Toliopoulos, right? He was just getting into, he was my partner in crime too, I'm not gonna say, but that was my partner in crime. Mm-hmm. So we had this idea. I said, since, you know, I'm a quote unquote rapper, you're a DJ, we can put together an album. You know how to produce? He said, I got some ideas. So he asked me, what do we need? I said, we need to get an MPC. We got an MPC 62. And we sat down in this basement and crafted a album. His brother, John Toliopoulos, came up with this three-chord melody. Bum, 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 bum. What do you think, cousin? What do you think? And cousin in Greek is like, my homie. What do you think, homie? What do you think? I was like, yeah, that's nice. And we put the track together, so it was I Can't Do It Alone. Mm-hmm. And then Harry the Blade B, he knew this young lady named Tina Renee, who has talent in her fingernails, man. The girl can. I've never seen a black Latino woman before.
Mm-hmm.
All black and would curse your ass out like a Latina woman. Oh, Tina had pipes. The girl can. Whoo, we talking about Whitney Houston, Patti LaBelle. The girl can sing.
Yeah, we had a, yeah, what was that track? I had a track that I had promoted for them when she had a solo out. I'll think about it eventually. Okay. Go ahead.
And, so when I asked Tina to sing this song, Do Your Thing was on my label. When I asked Tina to sing this song, she said, yeah, okay. And she wrote it. So there was a my, oh, Once Bitten was the song, right?
Mm-hmm.
So we had two bona fide songs, and Ping and I just put together a nice album. So we wanted to shop it. Went to Strictly Rhythm, went to Nervous, because those were the two biggest labels that I think I could think of that I thought that may pick it up. Nope, it didn't happen. So I was like, you know, like, fuck. You want to try Rocky?
They were very Nervous and Strictly were very New York, other than Bill. And Bill had a good relationship with Barry G over at Strictly. So.
Yeah, I did too, man. But it was the thing was I knew Gladys because she was at Nervous at the time, but I had just missed Gladys, Ping and I missed Gladys with this other record called I Robbed the Mailman that we did.
Mm-hmm.
And she came. Gladys, I think she may have been upset. I'm not for sure. I never talked to her about it. But she may have been upset because by the time she got back to us, we couldn't wait no longer for her to say, yeah, okay, we're going to release this record. So we released it with Dance Mania on our own little imprint, right, so to speak. Yeah, we know we sampled your copy of Get Down, Everybody.
Yeah, at that time that was about $10.99. That was an expensive record. Imports went up for a while.
Hey, no, actually, Chris, we didn't take yours. Ping had it, unless you gave Ping your record. But we got it from Ping. That Get Down, Everybody. Anyway, so that's kind of how the album went. And then again, here comes Benji. Mm-hmm. Was like, bro, you did it again. This is another big record. So I'm like, oh, okay, whatever. I didn't hear anything about it. Didn't know nothing about it. And then this artist from the UK named Christine W.
Yeah, good stuff.
Yeah, because I think Chris may have played it. Somebody, Ping, one of these DJs played it, and it's the exact same thing.
Feel What You Want.
Feel What You Want.
Yeah.
Oh, I was pissed. I went to Rocky. Was like, yo, we got to sue these people because they took my song. What you gonna do? You didn't do anything for Crystal Waters because Crystal Waters took my song. You didn't do anything with that. What you gonna do? Chris say bullshit. Oh, I love my brother Chris. Oh, this dude is funny.
Yeah.
Maybe I did, Chris. I don't know, bro. But I think Ping had the record. I can't remember taking it out the kitchen. I sampled it out the kitchen. But anyway, you can tell Chris and I have fun time. That's my brother, man. Dude, you don't even understand. That's,
you know, we came out of the Crowbar one night. Him, at the time, wasn't my wife yet. She was still my girlfriend. And we come out of, was it Crowbar? I think it was Crowbar. And my car got towed. Right, this is about 97, and I'm like, how do you tow my car? What, why is my car towed? Because I parked in an area where it said, you know, parking, and the cop looks, says, see that sign up there? No parking. It's 20 feet in the air. He says, I'm 5'3". I can't see that. I had no clue, and it cost me like $200 to get my car.
Yes, yes.
That was when I was me, Chris. Linda, and we went by. I think he got a tattoo that night too. Just out of nowhere. I think he decided to get a tattoo that night. I can't remember.
Wow.
Yeah. God, I love
it. It's a little, see, like when Chris and them used to do WLUW.
Yeah, they, energy, yeah.
Yeah, they had this thing at Kaboom. some of the best times of my life, man. Hanging out with Chris, Jen, and Brian. What's my man? Oh man, Brian gonna kill me if I forget his last name. Chris, help me out. Brian Clark. Brian Clark. Sorry, Brian Clark, and DJ Ping, all from Energy LUW. Man, I used to love hanging out with them because, man, they used to get me wrecked. I mean, like, I never heard of eraser heads and zipper heads and these kinds of drinks, and I'm all fucked up.
You know, remember when the Billboard Dance Music Summit came to town in 97? You remember that? That was a haze, bro. That was a big haze.
Yeah, I remember it, but I wasn't in America. I was.
Oh, that's right. You were in Berlin.
No, I wasn't in Berlin. I was in Europe. Yeah. I didn't actually physically move until 2000. I moved from Chicago in 1999. No, I moved to Chicago in 1999, beginning of 1999. And moved to Germany that following. So, like, the end of the year. So, December 1999, I moved to Europe, to Munich first. And then from Munich, I thought I was going to go to Amsterdam because I'm a pothead. I'm sorry. But then Holland was too small of a country. I was like, fuck that. In case this music industry started drying up, I could be in a country where I can go up and down the country and make a living. So Germany was that country.
So why did you move? So what possessed, I mean, why did you go out there? Did you go to Europe to work? Did you just not want to be here anymore? How did you choose going over there? What sent you over there?
Okay. What sent me was, Chicago politics.
Mm-hmm. Are you talking politicians or politics with DJs and radio?
But that last one, DJs and radio. Mm-hmm. So I really didn't. My peers didn't seem to want to have any type of unity. Also, my peers was traveling over in Europe, but wasn't giving me any connection. So Eddie Flash and folks from Detroit called me up around 1995 and say, hey, man, let's do a song together. Mm-hmm. Ooh, I get to Detroit. The one thing that we didn't do was a song. But what he did do, he educated me on how to get this money in the music business. Him and Mike Banks from Underground Resistance, love them, but they talked to me about the publishing, the importance of my publishing and my mm-hmm. catalog.
Yeah. And that's the business of music, Tyree. That's it.
And peace, my brother Beto. Peace, brother. So they taught me that. And in 95, Eddie Folks didn't want to travel anymore. So he gave me like four of his gigs. He gave me four of his gigs over in Europe. And I didn't ever look back after that. I found a booking agent who knew who I was and just kept going after that. So in 98, I was kind of like tired of Chicago and asking different people if they could put me on the party to get $150, $250 was. And I was like, fuck that, I'm out of here. So yeah, that's what prompted me to leave the country, period. Didn't know I was going to stay that long. Mm-hmm. As a matter of fact, Sal, I had a good time my first year there because I was in the studio doing an album, but the studio was the same studio as the Scorpions.
Wow. Right?
The guy, Dieter Dierks, he opened his doors to me and let me have basically a run of his place, man. I mean, literally. I met German rock bands that knew my name. I met Belgian rock bands. I mean, these are popular bands in Europe, right? They knew my name, so I had fun hanging out with these guys when I first moved there. Different rappers that was quote unquote hip hop artists in Germany knew who I was, and we talking about this is the 90s, so this late 90s. So I had a real good time. And then on top of that too, I could be in a party and not one person knew who I was. So I had total anonymity until I opened my mouth and they went, wait, what's your name again? No, you're not. Yeah. So that's what made me move to Europe But I've been going there. I've been going back and forth south since 1995. I lived in Amsterdam for 3 months. I lived in London, or the outside of London, in Basildon or Leiden, for 7 months. So I made sure I got a good taste of. I mean, I watched Speed Garage or Speed Garage become a thing. I watched Two Step become a thing. I watched, you know, like different genres become a thing being in Europe so long. But I had a good time, man.
Yeah, when I was building, when I got into the internet side of things, which was actually 95 when I started getting into the internet, and I started noticing what was going on. Like, yeah, you'd notice everything going on in Europe. I'm like, man, there's this shit called Dream House. It's just, you know, then it became trance. You know?
Right.
But, right. And everybody was still fighting over here, you know, when you talk to politics about who created this. Or, like, dude, there's stuff going on outside your front door that we should probably, if we work together, we can make some shit happen.
Keyword, work together. Bro, I'm sitting in places. I remember time, Sal, this is the funniest shit. I'm sitting in Germany. I did a club. It's called Terminal One. I almost said it in Germany. Terminal One. And let's say within a calendar year, I played the party in January. In June, the house music wasn't even a thing.
Mm-hmm.
It was, they called it electro, but it was just bastard house music. It was house music mixed with punk or rock or whatever. Mm-hmm. I couldn't get a job DJing because they had never heard of house music. And I'm in Europe. It had switched that quick, that dramatically. We talking about 2000 to 2003.
Mm-hmm.
It was like, yo, what is house? Like, wait, you got to be kidding. You never heard of. You don't know this artist. You don't know this artist.
Everything was 138 and up, boy.
Man, not even. Yeah, 130. In Europe, it wasn't so fast, but it was fucking fast. I was 127 and up. Yeah. You know what I mean? Yeah. It was still to the point where that faded out, and then all of a sudden, they figured out, oh, this is house.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, I've been there that kind of long. Where, they didn't know what house was, to not to know what it was, till they figured it out. Oh, this is house. Till they try to recreate the exact same thing we did in Chicago.
Yeah, and it became a revised version of what was done here in Chicago. It was revised for European market.
Really, really, really revised. Because they thought, they think every black DJ started out playing hip hop and then eventually graduated to house. Mm-hmm. Like, no, I was there from day one. What you mean day one? Like, day one, you know, like, from the first motherfucking record. Oh, really? Like, dude, see, you start realizing, like, hold on, how old are you? Oh, right, right. You don't even know what vinyl is. Oh, what's vinyl?
Oh, that's a trip, isn't it? Yes.
Even to the point where, I mean, I played in Israel, right?
Mm.
I'm trying to think, it's Tel Aviv or Jerusalem, one of the two. And I'm playing a disco set, so to speak. And they're screaming like they knew exactly what it was, but they had no idea what was playing.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm in Israel, bro.
Yeah, they're there for the experience, my friend, to enjoy the experience.
They're the experience, because bats be flying around your head at nighttime you don't know nothing about.
Yeah.
Yeah, so it was nice. What's this island, Ibiza, right? Or Ibiza, depending on your pronunciation.
Yeah.
Your pronunciation. I played there from 1995 up until 2001. Ah, Phil, brother. Oh, that's Frank Muzzalupo. I'm thinking Phil Muzzalupo. What's up, brother? I played there until they had cool parties, right? These cool parties. This was the revised version of house music. This is, you know, yeah, they oh shit, Vinnie Washington. The old school DJs, new DJs, kind of like mixed up. It was really, really something. I'm sorry. Go ahead.
No. Go ahead. Go ahead. I'm looking at the comments, bringing them in, bringing them out while you're talking.
Okay.
I got like 20 windows open. So
okay.
If I get lost, just slap me.
To the point, like I say, to the point where I started throwing my own parties, doing my own thing in Europe. I started in 2005. I was at this club in Hamburg called the China Club, right? And my party was called the Power Plant Revisited. Mm-hmm. That's why I had Daryl Pandy come in and do a live performance. And I tell you, 30 years, 20 years, 25 years later, that brother still brung it. I mean, he fell on the floor. The shoe went up in the air. And he started singing.
Animated. Loved it.
Hey, Sal, the motherfuckers in that club, man, them Germans in that motherfucking club, Sal, they was like, the fuck is
this? Is he okay?
Right. He kept on. He's like, I'm like, no, this part of his set. Is he all right? Like, this part of his, this part of what he does. And when he finished, when he was done, Zugabe means encore, right, in German. They kept screaming, Zugabe, Zugabe, Zugabe. I'm like, damn. And Daryl's like, Terry, what are they saying? I was like, they want you to do another song. Are you serious? I'm like, yeah, I told you that was going to happen. Oh, my God, Terry. And we didn't, it wasn't like a traditional stage. Hell, it was just a piece of rug that was next to the DJ booth. He, Daryl killed it. But from there, it started with my parties in Europe. Until I started doing them in Berlin, where Berlin is like Chicago in a lot of ways, like Chicago, New York, a lot of ways. The landscape reminds me of Chicago, but the attitudes are like New Yorkers and shit. So you got to kind of deal with this weird dynamic. They kept saying, Tyree, you can only do one club here, you can't do it every week. I'm like, how the fuck can y'all make some money this month if you can't do it? Okay, so me and my partner, Bobby Starr, we created this collective called Jack the Box. It's a group. We it's just the two of us. We created it so we could do our own parties. Sal, I tell you, we had three clubs running. And they was talking about doing every other month. So once a month, we had a club gate. We had a club date somewhere in Berlin. And so you can't
charge it, Tyree. What were they charging? And how'd you work the deal? Did you get the door? How'd that deal work out for you out there?
The first one we got the door, it was placed this little spot called Kleine Reise. I mean the little travel. That's what it means in German, right? But what the space was originally a Turkish bath. It was really a Turkish bathhouse. Kids are not down in the basement. And we got the door, so we did decent numbers, and then that demo went awry. So clubs started getting smart, so they started giving us budgets, right? They started handing out little budgets. So I'm the type of person that wants to have a party as opposed to get paid the money. So I'm looking for DJs that's reasonable within the budget, but not asking any DJ friends of mine to compensate the money. So we're talking like some months at Trezor, we might have a $5,000 budget. Slow months, maybe $3,000 budget. So everybody's fee has to come out of that because it was real strict. This other club we did called the Cats Meow, but it's called Katholzik,
in German, and translated, it's Cats Meow in English.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. They gave us a little bit better budget. We 4,000 a night when he had one DJ. So we, you know, try to make sure everybody got at least $1,000 for DJing, at least that. And then we had this other space. We had this other space that we had to create It didn't do so good. It's called Loftus Hall. It didn't do so good. It was just a lost cause, bro. It was putting more money in, not getting any out of it. But we had great DJs, too. I tried to book DJs that people may not have known, but they were good DJs. Hell, until I moved from Berlin, I was still trying to get the Hot Mix 5 to come to Europe. Still. Still, because no one, everyone has heard the Hot Mix 5, but nobody want to pay the money.
Well, yeah, you fly five guys over, or fly 10 guys over, no matter what. I mean, you're talking and putting them up, that's 10 G's.
And no club was trying to pay 10 G's. Right. Although I said, yo, if you got the Hot Mix legendary Hot Mix 5 in your club and you do the promotion or get a sponsorship, it's not going to fail because these guys, I don't care how dysfunctional people may think they are, but when they all together as a collective, the Hot Mix 5, I don't give a fuck. Can't nobody beat them. Man, look, we booked Farley, Lil Lewis, Marshall Jefferson was probably our biggest, most expensive, maybe one other French DJ was our biggest expense. Farley killed it. He's still legendary to this day in Berlin when we talk about our parties because he opened up the mic and opened up the turntables. The club was like, I'll put it like this. The owner of Trezor is a techno head, Dimitri Hagelman.
Yeah, they had their own label.
Yeah, great, exactly. Trezor had their own label, right.
Yeah.
He when Farley was there, he showed up at the party. That's how deep that party was. He was like, no, I'm meeting Farley Jackmaster Funk.
Mm-hmm.
And when he was finished, all my friends was like, yo, man, I see why house is so, was he like this back in the day? I was like, yeah, but he was much better back in the day.
And they walk in with expectations and they're already enamored just because in their eyes, these are the originators, the godfathers, the guys at the beginning. And when when I interviewed guys, even when we talked, Armin Van Buuren and David Guetta, you talk to these guys, they knew your names and their names. They knew the people from 84 or 85. They knew their names. These were the guys they patterned them. Tiesto. Oh, my God. You mentioned, Farley or Kenny Jam and Jason, the Hot Mix 5. Fast Eddie. He knew the B-sides of the shit. Mm-hmm. These guys knew it. And if, like we talked when you said earlier about the politics and the bullshit, if everybody could have just got through that shit and said, hey, get off your block, go over there, there's $1 million to be made over there. But it never came to be, which is a shame.
It kind of upset me because I'm watching Detroit with High Tech Soul, this movie in the movie theater. I'm like, I saw Chip E's movie, The Unusual Suspects. I saw Maestro, and I'm like, where's the rest of the movies at? Where, movie BPM and shit. I'm like, oh, fuck, where's Chicago? Where are we at? That's why I keep asking you religiously, as long as you've known me, Sal, what's up with the movies? How can we get down in the movies? What do we have to do to get, because we're not even discussed in pop culture, bro. When they do 90s music or 90s things, Chicago is so far removed.
It's nowhere to be found. And it has just a lot, again, Boogie knows this, and Chris especially, because I was not about, and just like you, we weren't about sides. We're about, hey, how can we get together? Let's make some dough. How do we make... But everybody had to, I had this mic crew over here. It's Mike Ritz. Why I always want, you've known me so long. I've always gone outside and made my shit happen. Because if you can't count on your own crew, well, then you got to go out there and make shit happen. That's all. And if you can bring some guys along, cool. If you can't,
hi, Sal. Yeah, Sal, we from the same school. We from the exact same school. And I booked Sundance for my party at the China Club in Hamburg. I booked Fast Eddie, a party, Gene Ferris, and that's in Hamburg. Up in Berlin, I booked Farley, Lil Lewis, or we McFarlane, Lil Lewis. I was going for Frankie Knuckles until the club said, Trezor said, Frankie Knuckles is too expensive. I'm like, don't y'all, this is a club. This is a famous club. You mean to tell me you motherfuckers can't get a sponsorship?
Right. How did that work in Europe? Were sponsorships a little different? I mean, sponsorships here come in all different ways. But I mean, I would assume universally across the board, you can find a way to get somebody to pick up the tab. You know, some countries might have, no liquor companies can sponsor stuff on the radio or TV. But, you know, there's a way.
Berlin, the thing with Trezor, it wasn't that they couldn't, they wouldn't.
Mm.
I said, me and my partner suggested, let's get Frankie Knuckles. Oh, he's too expensive. Okay, how about Tony Humphries? Oh, he's too equally expensive. They came back to us and said, we got the perfect DJ for you. We was like, oh God.
Paris Hilton.
He said, Ron Hardy. We looked, he's like, and I bust out laughing. He's like, what's wrong? Ron Hardy's not. I'm like, yeah, he would be perfect if he was alive. No, I talked to him on Facebook. No, that's not Ron. That's not Ron. That's his nephew. No, it's there. I said, I know who it says. That's his nephew, Bill. That's not Ron Hardy. Oh, man. I was like, well, still, what about Tony Humphries?
Mm-hmm.
Can we get Tony Humphries? I don't think he's as expensive as Frankie Knuckles. And I said to them, let's get Frankie Knuckles in Trezor to make Trezor that club before our heroes start passing. Oh, no, Tyree. No. So I tried Steve Hurley too.
Mm-hmm.
Steve Hurley was just a bit too pricey for the club because I wouldn't have walked home with no money, and I had to make some money.
Yeah.
Steve Hurley was just too pricey, and that's the only reason we didn't do Steve Hurley. But I tried to get as many Chicago people. I booked Mike Dunn in 2008 at a club. It was called the Tape Club. This, Sal, was the club of fucking clubs, bro. It was one. It was like the fun.
Multi-level? How many square feet? Multi-level kind of club?
Square feet. Sal, the motherfucker was a football field.
Oh, Jesus.
It was a warehouse for days, bro. And they sectioned it off.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, my God. What a sound. Sal, just.
Like those old raves in the 90s. They used to just hold them in fields. And they were just like in a field with a tent that went on forever.
Right. And that was the first time I seen Serato because Mike Dunn came. He's like, man, Ty, you got to get Serato. You got to get this. And I'm like, Serato, what the fuck? And he started playing all this old stuff. I'm like, oh, hell no.
Mm-hmm.
The best piece of music I've ever worked on. I'll tell you in a minute, Chris. So I really tried to book as many. We had Maurice. I booked Maurice Joshua. I'm like, hell no. How brother gonna have a Grammy and y'all don't know who the fuck he is?
Yeah.
Oh, the fuck out of here. No, we booking Maurice Joshua.
Mm-hmm.
I don't care. He remixed Beyonce. He got a Grammy. And that's all I kept saying. He got a Grammy. He got a Grammy. Name me one DJ present company withstanding has a Grammy that walked through your door. Well, we don't carry out. I said, listen. You name me an artist in your country who doesn't want a Grammy. Yeah, I know they got the Echo Award here, but the Echo is no Grammy. Mm. It doesn't even compare in status.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. I said, but he has one. So we booked Maurice Joshua. I was trying to go for Marley Marl, one of my other favorite DJs. To answer Chris's question, the best piece of music I ever worked on. It's interesting. Turn Up the Bass is my favorite song that I've ever done. I Fear the Night is that special first song, like your first love, like your first kiss and things like that. So I'm always going to have a special place for I Fear the Night. Acid Over carries a whole lot of memories of hearing it in the UK tomorrow. This song was the summer of love. So the best piece of music I ever worked on, I don't know, it could be the band that we had. Oh, I ain't gonna never let it down, Chris. We did Born Under Bad Sign and shit. We was jamming out in a what's name basement.
Born Under a Bad, what, the blues song?
Born Under a Bad Sign, brother.
Yeah, all right.
Okay. Ooh, we matter of fact, we did a we made it a rap song, but with before
was that little
Little Feet? That's right, Little Feet.
Yeah,
Little Feet. That's right. That's right. Yeah. I don't know. I had a great time working on music. Like I say, one of my other thrills was hanging out in the studio with the in the studio of the Scorpions was amazing. I don't know, my best piece of music I worked on. It's a lot. It's kind of hard to tell, but I Fit a Night, Turn Up the Bass is my favorite. Video Crash is another one.
Little Stevie King, wasn't it? Wait a minute. Born Under a Bad Sign.
Yeah, Born Under a Bad Sign. We used the Little Feet version because I think that's who did it second or first. Matter of fact, they may have did
Albert
it first.
King. Yeah, it was Albert King.
Was it Albert King?
Yeah.
It was Albert King song.
Yeah, Albert King. I know. Because in my other industry, I play that just to piss some girls off.
What is this?
Shut up and hop the pole.
What? Oh, man. No, that was shit. We rehearsed that song religiously and a few other songs, and me being the main vocalist and shit. What else?
You know what one of my favorites was, Tyree?
What's that?
Dude, I would play it 2 or 3 times a night at Safari Club just because it was banging. This.
Oh, shit. Anybody?
Yeah. I love this. Basically, keep you dancing. Something hitting hard like a cannon. Coming out just like I plan to. Real funk, make you dance to.
Another jam produced by Tyree. Get up and move. That's another favorite of mine.
Yeah. That's one of my favorites.
Because.
Banging.
I asked him first. He would have been he would have been first on Turn Up the Bass, JMD, but he didn't want to do it. He didn't want to do it.
Really?
Yeah, he didn't want to do it.
See, and that had a lot of production in it, dude. That was when you look at, you know, from I Fear the Night to that, you got pianos, you got the samples, you got that sax sample. You know, I mean, all of a sudden now it's a lot deeper than just a beat track.
Yeah, yeah.
And this is what a lot of house guys, you know, Steve started early beat tracks. It evolved from just DJ music with tracks and a hook to songs.
Yeah.
Of the song. Yeah.
I always try to do something different, be a little different, not stay the same and stagnant. Like hanging out with y'all was like me going to college, grad school, because y'all were on it. Like when I go down on Rush Street, or if I hang out in the Birds with you and Frankie and stuff, y'all was sort of on a different level. Me listening to y'all DJ, it opened my ear for a whole nother sound. So by the time I got to the studio, I'm trying to search my way around for these sounds, search my way around for this kind of piano, or this kind of bass, or, you know, whatever, because y'all was opening my eyes to a whole lot of different things and shit, right? So I always enjoyed it. Like I said, even Maurice Joshua's brother, Xavier, when Chris used to work at Eddie Rockets and shit.
Yeah.
I love hanging out down there because... Yeah. That was the place I learned how to control a club.
Especially the Skin to Win night. Especially the Skin to Win night. Don't judge me. Don't judge me.
Right.
Put some clothes on.
How was it working with Muzz 5? Phil, you know how it was. We only did one song with you. I'm still asking you for the cassette that you, for a copy of the song that you still won't give it to me. So I'm going to put it on blast. You're still my little brother. But it was cool working with you, because you asked me out the blue to help you out, and I think I gave you a banger, because we were trying to get that shop to Strictly Rhythm as well. I gave him a banger. Okay.
You know, and this, you know, like you said earlier, Tyree, too, a lot of it, you know, you left your block. I left my block. Dude, I remember being in the subway at 4:30 in the morning at 15, 16 years old, going from one party or going to working at a club, because you got to learn that, hey, just because this is this kind of person doesn't mean that they're not into different. I learned so much shit culturally by just leaving my neighborhood and getting out of the hood and going, wow, there's like a whole world out here. Shit.
Okay. Again, I did the same thing, man. What's the man? Charlie. I can't think of Charlie. You know Charlie used to run Jumping Music.
Was that Julian's buddy from MSC?
Yeah, that same
yeah,
one.
Yeah, Charlie.
I used to ask Charlie if I could do some of his parties, and Charlie parties was way the fuck northwest.
Yeah.
I would go from Inglewood, like 63rd and Ashland to 6300 West on Narragansett or some old crazy shit, right? So I'm way the fuck out my neighborhood, or I'm doing a party with Charlie and or either Tony Bedea. We out in fucking Maywood. Now I have no car.
Mm-hmm.
We did a party with Farley, and I asked Farley to take me into the city. In the city, I had to get a ride to another party. Just take me to the city. He's like, nope, I ain't got enough room. My records got to sit down. I'm like, get the fuck out of here. So I had to go from Maywood to 90 to 100 and what was 103rd, I think, in Michigan, where Mendel was, because I had to play at Mendel that same night. But yeah, man, you had to. I'm with you, son. Get out my neighbor. I stayed down on Rush Street. I mean, I'm a brother. I'm a black man on Rush Street. I stick out like a sore fucking thumb.
But dude, I was a white guy at the Taste Entertainment Center and Nimbus.
You did not go to Nimbus. No. You were a great white guy.
I was about 12. If my mother knew, I was. Dude, I had a mustache already by the time, you know, right around 6 years old, it started coming in, you know. So most people thought I was already 25, 30, and the drinking age at that time was still 18. And I just had this, like you, I wanted to know what the hell was going on. Even when Chris was running the pool, why I got so interested in wanting, I wanted to know what the hell's going on in Seattle. What are they playing? What are they into? What are the black clubs doing? White clubs doing? What are the gay clubs doing? I wanted to know what everybody was listening to and why. What made it part of their culture?
That's me. That was me too. Yeah. That was that. And you know what, Sal? It didn't even stop when I went to Europe because the European scene was way different than the American scene. I'm like, this how y'all party? Let me see what y'all doing. Okay, let me see what's going on over here. I had some, you know, you got friends of all walks of life and everything. So whatever they partied at, I would hang out with them. And, you know, I'm a pothead, bro. And in Europe, I smoke pot everywhere. Mm. Even when it wasn't legal, even when it wasn't supposed to, even when I was getting kicked out the club, it kept my sanity.
never did, and don't care who does. I don't see, never did. You know, I tell people there's three things I don't care who does, and I just don't. Tyree, I don't put ketchup on my hot dog either. You know, there's just shit that don't cross my mind. And I've sat in rooms with people who have done mountains of blow, and they look at each other and go, here, watch this. So, you want a party? Get the fuck out of here. You got some food? That was my question. Where's the food? I don't give a shit about that. Give me my food. That's all I care about.
That's me and Europe. Hey, Tyree, you want a lot? No, motherfucker, I don't. Where the weed at? Matter of fact, I leave y'all here. I'm going out where the women at, because it's too many. It's a sausage fest back here. I'm going with the women. Oh man, it's not like that. I know it's not like that because, goddamn it, I'm gonna leave y'all here. Y'all doing this shit and they coming back eyes this damn big and they glass. I'm like, wow.
Well,
nope, I'm not doing that shit.
You know, that rave scene, Tyree, I know, were you there in 91, 92 when Big Beat became more of the techno and the rave stuff? Were you there yet? No, you were still here, right? So I get to Dusseldorf and they'd signed a deal with Emma and Theater at Dance Street. And I go to a rave.
With who? With Dieter,
yeah, at Dance Street.
Get out of Dodge.
Yeah, that's how we got Sinner Man licensed all over Europe and the Far East was through Dieter.
That's right.
That was when I had Cool Rock on Sinner Man. I said, hey, Mom, you want to do a record for me? Okay. And I had Omar Santana do the production with couple guy, we did it at Art the Baker studio in New York, and we licensed it out. So anyways, they dragged me to a rave. in Germany, and I had no idea. Dude, they were partying for 3 days, stoned out of their mind. People are like, I said, that doesn't even look like fun. That didn't even look like fun, man.
No.
It wasn't weed. It was all kinds of other shit they were doing. I honest to God, I think they were just eating sheep's ass or something. I don't know what the hell they were putting in their body.
Those were the early days of MDMA, ecstasy.
Yeah.
That was the early days. And yeah, I witnessed it first in the UK around 1990 when like this whole
breakbeat stuff was breaking at that time.
Yeah, Sal. Yeah. When it was like Orbital has just started making their first records, and Chemical Brothers the Chime and these type of groups was coming out, this down tempo, drugged out type of sound, but it was all electronic, all broken beat. There was very little four to the floor. But the party was like, I did this one rave in the UK. I kid you not, they had this humongous lava lamp. This is like the biggest lava lamp I've ever seen in my life, man. I'm like, the fuck? I mean, it wasn't one, but it looked like one because the shit was going down real slow.
Speaking of that, go ahead. I forgot to put on my lava lamp. There we go.
No. It was humongous. Imagine that motherfucker like 7 or 8 feet tall or some shit.
Yeah.
So,
the black lights and the glow in the dark posters too?
Oh, they no posters, but they because it was in a tent, right? And I'm on stage performing, and because I'm on stage performing doing my hip house thing, and I noticed again 6 months prior to that, everybody's hands in the air. Oh yeah, I love this. 6 months later, it was like, all right, mate, that's enough. I don't want to hear this shit no more. I want to hear some beats. I want to hear this. So but my very, very first rave I went to was in Chicago, like a rave was in Chicago. Oh, I love that poster.
Tell me that ain't seventh grade makeout music with Earth, Wind, and Fire's live version of Reasons playing.
Fuck yeah, dude. Without the makeout, just Earth, Wind, and Fire.
Yeah, and first time a girl put her tongue in my mouth, I was like, what are you looking for? I had no idea what she was doing. What the hell are you doing? Yeah, okay, sounds cool. Let's do it. I think I ate her nose. I had no idea. It was like sixth grade, fifth grade. The hell did I know? But yeah, right. these posters were the bomb back then, man.
Yes.
Black lights and live version.
Sneak had one the other day, and I'm like, wow, Sneak, you just took me back to when I was in sixth and seventh grade with the posters and shit.
Yeah.
But yeah, I think my first raid was in Illinois. Was in Chicago, the first quote rave that I went to. But Europe, I went to one in Europe, which made me believe, okay, this is a real rave. No offense to the one in Chicago, no offense to it. It was just that Big Love was fucking humongous.
It was culturally different, Tyree. That's why, because it was there, just like our house parties. You can't do our house parties over there, and that because that was us. It's our culture. It's embedded in how we're brought up. That rave was their creation, really. You know what I mean?
Right. They did it right. Exactly.
We tried to. We Americanized our version of a rave, but we didn't have a football field to go do MDMA and ecstasy for 3 days. You couldn't do that here.
Hey man, Big Love was on. It was on acres of land, 40, 50 acres of land. We talking about fucking you. It was so many people, man, on the M25 going to this place. And then it was just not just that one. It was like three or four of them motherfuckers on a weekend. You know, it wasn't like, you know, that's the one we gonna go to and everybody gonna have, man, no, it was that one, then the next one, then all of a sudden there was no more raves.
So no more raves. When you were in Europe, did you get to hang out with Paul Van Dyke? You get to hang out with him, Carl Cox? Did you get to hook up with any of them or do anything with them?
Funny you should say, Carl Cox I didn't really hang out with him. Met him a couple times. Mm-hmm. Said hello. But Paul Van Duke, I'm saying like I'm German.
Mm-hmm.
Paul Van Duke is a really, really, really down-to-earth dude.
Everybody says the same exact thing, Tyree, no matter who's down to
them. When I say down-to-earth, man, this motherfucker is rich beyond control.
Mm-hmm.
But when he booked me for his party, I thought he was on. I'm like, Paul, are you on drugs? He's like, no, man, are you one of my favorite DJs? I like your music from back in the day. I'm like, but yo, your music and my music don't mess, bruh. He said, don't worry about it, Ty. Don't worry about it. They'll be here. I'm like, bruh. And sure enough, in Berlin, he had this party. This party was so packed. We were on stage at least 100 feet away from the people. He was far back on the stage, and I was still sweating.
Mm-hmm.
And when I played after Paul, I'm like, oh, you're done? He said, no, I have to come back, because if I leave this party, the people go with me. Ah, people, schmeeple, they're not going nowhere with you. Well, half that dance floor left when he walked away from the turntables.
Mm-hmm.
And when he came back, the club was overpacked again.
Mm-hmm.
I'm like, the fuck? But Paul Van Duke, very good guy, very good guy. Tiesto, I'd never met. Carl Cox and not. Carl Cox, Paul Oakenfold, Fast Eddie, and myself did a party together. Back in 89. Who else did I meet? So many other ones. There's so many people I met, Sal, that's the moment I meet them, they say that one line, you know, Tyree Cooper, the producer, and they're happy to sing it. I just be laughing like, you play trance music. How do you know hip house? You play techno. What do you know about, you know, hip house? You play chill out music. And that's, chill out. That's another side of music I like, that chill out
shit. Dude, some of that stuff, even from the early 2000s, like telepop music and all that downtempo, 07. Ooh, man.
Yeah.
Too Wiki had some great stuff, man. Yeah. All that downtempo, chilled out. I had a channel when I was running another network, and it was all downtempo, dude. And we were cumin. 300,000 people a month, and I was just, Double Lab, all kinds of great stuff.
Yeah, and, dude.
And to be honest with you, Chris, when Chris was running the pool, turned me on to a lot of really good stuff too. You know, people turn me on to stuff, then I determine whether or not I'm going to enjoy it, I'm going to use it, I can work it, depending on what I need it for. And Chris, just like Daft Punk, and I got in trouble for it. Chris was telling me about Daft Punk. And I had Modern Tracks. I was just getting ready to release a new format on Modern Tracks called Street Style. So he tells me about this group, this artist called Daft Punk, these guys out in Europe, and they're on Virgin Records or something. And so I check it out. I was like, dude, that's wicked. I got to make that the first song on the new CD for the subscribers. So I put it on. And, dude, I swear to Rick Squillante was at Virgin. He and I were screaming. I told this to Curtis Urbina, because Curtis was good friends with Rick at the time. I said, dude, we were going to kill each other at the Winter Music Conference. He was so livid. And I had gotten clearance from the distributor to do it. I wasn't going to do it unless I had coverage. So, but he was so pissed. I said, look, talk to your distributor. Don't yell at me about this. We had a massive blowout. But when you even like Daft Punk had some really great stuff that you just, when you got into those album tracks that were so chill, and it didn't necessarily mean you even needed to know the name of the song. Was there a lot of stuff like you said to you just listen, you go, man, that's really nice. Poetic Justice, Stanley Clark from the Poetic. You talk about a downtempo groove,
man. Oh, yeah, dude.
Great stuff, man.
And that's what you, and that's another thing that's something else that Europe did for me too, right? It really opened my eyes. Oh, peace out to Sydney. I had a great time in Sydney, Australia. Europe really opened my eyes to all formats of music. So like Benji, I'll let me out there Thursday. Like Benji used to say, Benji tell me all the time, Tyree, it ain't all about the brothers, man. It ain't all about the brothers. You gotta put some stuff in there for the Latin brothers too. You gotta put some stuff in there for the, for Rush Street. You gotta do stuff for them. I'm like, Benji, there's too many motherfuckers I got to think about, bro. See, I'm telling you, Ty, don't close your mind. And Europe when I went to Europe and stayed a long period of time, oh man, I got a seriously different appreciation for music.
Yeah, you realize how much is out there, man. How much great music.
Great, there you go. That's it. That's it. Great music, not just good. Great music. Yeah, yeah, and like two-step. I was into two-step big time because it gave me the energy. Like, I love house music. When something gives me that, when I hear a music genre that gives me fulfillment, I always attest it to house music because house just fills me the fuck up. I can listen to house, old Chicago house, to present day Chicago house, New York house, California house, Ohio house, Mississippi house. I don't give a fuck. As long as it got house in it, I can listen to that all day, but I like to expand my horizon a little bit and listen to a lot of the Broken Beat stuff, some of that stuff from the Wagami Brothers, Rennie Foster, shit like that. I was into that kind of shit. Oxide and Neutrino that does two stuff. Some of my UK brothers, Norris the Boss, EZ, MC Creed, that all they do, these guys that do Speed Garage and shit. I'm one of the few artists that has a legendary song as a Speed Garage artist.
Which one?
It's called The History of House Music by Tuff Jam. I performed this song 3 times in the UK when it came out because it was a now it's a classic. So this organization called Back to 95, when they do their parties, hell, they used to book me, man, on the regular. Like, okay, Tyree, you gotta perform this song. I'm like, are you serious? And Susan, come on. Then this is house music. Oh yeah. Here we go. I'm gonna take you on a trip. They go, all right, Tyree, all right, motherfucker. And it's such a joy, man. And even listening to Speed Garage or Speed Garage. Two-step. Only thing I didn't really like was like this mashed up shit. Like I said, it's bastardized house music. I wear sunglasses at night with a fucked up techno beat on top.
Oh, yeah, when you do Depeche Mode, your rhythmics, everybody throws all that shit on the end. They throw a house beat in there. Well, that's for the clubs that say you can't play house music. You say, I'm not, I'm playing the Eurythmics. I'm playing the Eurythmics, asshole. Go fuck yourself.
Right. That's something I couldn't fuck with.
Yeah.
But the other stuff, man, like, yeah, minimal music. Nah, that shit was. I had an argument with a guy in Germany. He's like, man, minimal is going to take over house. I'm like, dude, house is a culture. This shit just got its ground. You got to survive the hard days. This minimal shit ain't did none of that. Or it's going to take over house. Okay. I said, minimal music is house music with no soul.
No, there's nothing to it.
Soul out of it, that's minimal.
There's nothing to it. There's nothing. You know, like Mike Dunn, you know, like Jesse remixed the It's Okay, and there's a bunch of really great remixes on It's Okay that are out there. And Mike's got these two tracks, man, that I love. It's Natural High.
Oh, yeah.
You know, and that's the feeling. Man. It really is. It's a feeling. It's a groove. And I don't know, for me, it's more based in that 74 to 77 Philly International sound. It really is the soul, the vibe, the groove, Earl, you know, the drums, that four on the floor with the hi-hat just banging.
I did a remix for It's Okay, but Jesse didn't like mine. He said mine was too basic.
Well, you know, you're only 4 hours away from him now. You can go down. You can go.
I left it alone. I'm gonna do another mix. I told him I'm going to do another mix for myself that you're not going to like, so it'll be just for me. All I did was take the original and just try to spice it up a little bit because I like it as it was. I didn't think it needed a remix.
You know, there was this shit, and Chris Jim, remember, in the early 90s when techno was getting really out of control. I had this discussion with Jesse a couple of weeks ago and a couple of others. Techno had gotten so stupid. We got into the stuff that was really popular in Australia, and it was called Goa. And it was 200 and something beats a minute of insanity. Ooh. Absolute insanity. Bang, bang. You know, it was bad enough that pointing from Rotterdam, you know, bang, bang, bang. This stuff was just banging. I don't know what kind of drugs you could have possibly have done even acknowledge that this thing was a song. I don't know how screwed up you had to be. But some of this shit sold for a while.
Dude, listen, you talk about from Rotterdam, it was called Gaba. G-A-B-A, Gaba.
That's what I meant. Not Gaba. 200
BPMs per minute.
Nuts.
It's insane. And then Goa. Okay, I got a funny experience.
That's more on that trance side. The Goa was more on the trancier side.
You throw a Goa party today in Europe? Not today, but once this pandemic is over and someone has a Goa party, if they got enough space, I'm guaranteeing you 20,000 people.
Yeah, that Goa size stuff was huge 15, 16 years ago.
It ain't with no West Side. That's what I'm trying to explain to you. When I was in Berlin, I'm talking about, I love me some house, I love me some hip hop. But I'm talking about this close, not Gaber, Gab.
Yeah, well, yeah, it was Gaber or Gab. I know it wasn't Goa, but...
Yeah, no. I was this close to throwing a Goa party in Berlin.
Reavy D, I'm offended.
Dude, because that shit, yo, Sal, the people come from everywhere.
Yeah.
Everywhere. Bro, just all walks of life, they coming. I'm like, are you serious? Like, man, yeah, Goa party, you could never go wrong. I'm like, for real? And that hustler side of me, like, for real? Okay. Who are the DJs? Name me some main players in the DJs, and I find the rest of the people to fill it out. But I was this close to throwing a Goa party because, yo, man.
They turn out big time. Yes.
Yeah.
And it's for the experience. It's for the experience.
I was just about to say that. It's not my music.
Exactly.
But there are some records in that genre that are not really bad.
Mm-hmm.
It's not really bad. So like somebody, if they find a Goa track, they go, oh, how you like this? You have to really get all that bullshit out your head and listen to it, and you will find appreciation. No, I'm not gonna sit up and try to dance to this motherfucker, you know, but to sit and listen to it,
mm-hmm.
it's not bad. What else? I did a party.
I took you seriously.
Yeah, you know, I took you
seriously. Yeah, Chris always filled in the voids. And I, you know, through the years, you just learn. You get over your prejudices about music. Because I don't give a shit. If people are liking it and it's not for me to, okay, I got to give it to them. It's not about what I like. Because I like, I'm going to be listening. Truth be told, I'll be listening to Sergio Mendez, Resist 66, ZZ Hill, Down Home Blues, little Bobby Blue Bland, some little Milton mixed in there with Your Wife Is Cheating on Us, and I'm the most fucked up white dude you're ever going to meet, because that's where my head is at all the time when I'm really listening to shit. There ain't an ounce of rock and roll to be found, nothing, but that's my favorite stuff. But when it comes into how do I got to entertain these people, if I'm doing a show, what are they in? I got to know it. And I got to give it to him. It's not about what I like.
And I never laughed at Chris. Like I said, we were roommates. Chris schooled me on the finer things of rock and roll and house music as well. Because one song that I never forget that reminds me of Chris, even right here today, I think it's called Soup. New York. That's so every time I hear it, it reminds me of Chris.
It's got that sack with that sack. That's
right. That's right. I took him serious.
Chris was working at a club. They had a phenomenal salad. The salad was amazing. The food was great. It was called Lola's.
Lola's. Okay. I wasn't here then.
Yeah. And then I would work there occasionally. And the guy who owned the joint, And dude, this was the time when Brooklyn Funk Essentials was real popular, and a lot, you know. And then a lot of the Latin house started getting popular. And that's another thing I really miss. I don't hear a lot of Latin house anymore, man. And I look for it because I love some of that stuff. And you just don't find a lot of it out there anymore. You just don't find all it is. It's reggaeton all day long. There's very little 122, 124, 126 Latin house. It's all that, you know, 90 to 100 BPM reggaeton and no house at all. I'm like, where the hell did all this stuff go?
What tripped me out in living in Germany. So I'm listening one day. I don't really pay attention to the radio. So somebody had the radio on. I was with somebody that had the radio on, and I'm hearing this freestyle music. I'm like, oh, they playing freestyle?
Mm-hmm.
Like, yeah, this is soul music. I'm like, who?
In Germany, right? In Germany, right?
Yeah, in Germany. I'm like, George the Bond.
Yeah.
Stevie B.
Lil Susie was huge in Germany, dude. Yes.
I had no idea, bro.
Yes.
I had no idea.
And ZZ, who's watching, you have freestyle. Dude, freestyle in Germany. I said the same thing. What the hell?
I'm listening to this. I'm like, wait, where am I at? He said, oh, this. And they play it. And they play it in the hip hop room.
Mm-hmm.
They're not playing it in the club room. They playing it in the black room, as they call it, because they call hip-hop black music, mm-hmm. right? So they playing it in the black room. And everybody in that room, they know the song. And I'm looking at it like...
Well, and check this out, Tyree. And culturally, that's them. That's what their perception is. Here mm-hmm. in the States, or even in Chicago, I don't care if you're in a black club or a white club, and you play house for this generation, why are you playing that techno shit? And you look at it and go... Techno, you culturally ignorant wench. This is house music. You vile specimen. Get out of my booth before I kick you in your throat. That's how violent I get about it, you know? It's like, they don't know. Whatever they're told, this is it. And they have no clue. Just like you said, they thought freestyle was hip-hop. Here, this kids today, all they know is hip hop or reggaeton. That's it. And you play house. Oh, that's techno. No, that's not techno.
I have that here in Vegas too, bro. It's like everyone knows what house is, but they don't know what house is.
Right.
A few DJs here, like one DJ, his name is Aaron Kelly. He lives here. He had a space. Party space, it was called Taco Tuesday.
Mm-hmm.
And it was all house. From my understanding, it was all house. And then they left it alone. So now they have, it's called a Downtown Cocktail Room, DCR. One DJ is from Chicago. One DJ is from Chicago, then Rob Alon. It's a nice space, but when you can't dance and you groove and you can't dance, it's not a party for me. It's hell in Chicago, a lounge room you party in. Hell, matter of fact, the Beatles used to play at this one little bar in Hamburg, Germany, that's still around to this day. And I went there with this young lady I was dating. And Sal, the room was about as big as the bathroom in the warehouse on Randolph Street. Mm. That's how big the space was. It was crowded, and they was playing house in this little bitty ass space. I mean, this mm-hmm. motherfucker was a cracker box.
Mm-hmm.
And it was playing house. What I want to tell you, I've been to Siberia, Sal. I've been to fucking Siberia to play
by house music. By choice?
But you know, I got booked there. It was Omsk, right? 500 miles from the Chinese River. That's how deep in Siberia I was.
Yeah, chances are I would have still been wearing shorts, dude. Honest to God, I was wearing shorts in the blizzard here. But go ahead.
Yeah, no, you would have wore shorts because the next day you would have had to find your winter coat because it was the ending. It was the last day of summer there.
Mm-hmm.
This was August. I've been to St. Petersburg and what they call White Knights. I'm like, the fuck is a White Knight? Mm-hmm. I'm not talking about yo, baby, yo. Mm-hmm. I'm talking about actual White Knights. I'm like, the fuck is that?
Was this guy?
When it's midnight and it looks like about 6 o'clock in the evening, because we that close to the equator.
Mm-hmm.
I'm like, okay, what time am I? I'm gonna get some sleep. He said, no, Terry, you going in an hour. I'm like, what you mean an hour, dude? I landed at 6. He said, no, we 3 hours ahead of Berlin. I'm sorry. Wait, it's 11 o'clock at night? And I'm looking up at the screen like, it's 11 o'clock at night? Mm-hmm. Like, yeah, dude, we going an hour. I'm like, I guess I don't get no sleep tonight. What else? Malta. I don't know if you have anybody.
Yeah, a little island out there, yeah.
Hey, that's the best island you ever want to go to. Peaceful. I seen, speaking of movies, I seen the Popeye set. From mm-hmm. the movie Popeye, I seen that set in Malta. And Malta is like a little Ibiza. It's a small-ass island with about 15 people on there, but everybody else is tourists that live there.
Like Arthur said, like Dudley Moore said in Arthur, it's so small they recently had the whole island carpeted. There are some of them one-liners from Dudley Moore and Arthur, dude.
True, though. Sada Island is about as big as their thumb. You go up, you go down, that's it.
Well, they have like a princess or a queen on Malta. And about 10 years ago, I was doing promo. God, I wish I could remember the girl's name. I was doing promo. She was a pop star, pop artist. And I was working promo for her in about 2009, 2010. She had a couple minor hits, but she was from Malta. Mm-hmm. And, you know, you got to be careful when you fly into Malta, because if the pilot's having a bad day, you're swimming back to the island. He's going to overshoot the island. You're screwed. And unless you're a very fat man, you're not going to float very well in the Mediterranean.
And, and you only, what, you only 35 minutes from Africa?
Depending on the wind, yeah.
But Malta, I dug Malta. I'm trying to think of the other weird place. Australia. I liked Australia. I know my man is here from Australia, but I liked what was it? Was it Adelaide? I think I was, when I saw a sloth, I think I was either Adelaide or Sydney when I saw a sloth
mm-hmm.
hanging out in the tree. I'm like, oh, that's nice. Oh, fuck, that shit is real.
Yeah, they move in slow motion. I know a lot of people like that.
And I showed my age in Sydney too, because I didn't know the cockatoo in Sydney. They're like sparrows here in America. Them and green parrots are everywhere, everywhere, really? Dude.
And they live forever,
dude. They must do, because yo, my man is driving, and on the telephone wire, I'm freaking. I'm like, yo, you ever seen this TV show called Beretta? And da da da. He had and dude said, what's Beretta? Wait, how old are you? Oh, man, I'm only 23. Oh, fuck, you wasn't even born, bro. Anyway, I had to explain to him what Beretta was.
Well, it only lasted a few seasons, Tyree. I mean, really. And speaking of, it's funny you bring that up, because I get to go to the Beats website, and on the Beat, you can watch that's the actual pilot episode of Beretta right there.
Yeah. Man. On his shoulder.
Yeah, Fred. Was it Fred? Fred. Yeah, there's a history of the show and everything. Because on the Beat, you know, on our website, the network, you've got like 300 pilot episodes and 500 movies you can watch for free. Beretta's one of them. So they didn't know who Beretta was in Australia? Really?
Not a clue. Wow. And then on top of that, bro, I went to the Outbacks. And, hey, man, listen, my Australian trip
mm-hmm.
was an experience and a half, because I know what it feels like when someone is watching you. Because I saw my first Aborigine and was looking at this dude like, hell no, you're real. And I kept looking at him, and I kept saying, I'm sorry, please excuse me. I'm not trying to look at you like that, but I've only used to seeing Aborigines in a textbook, and I'm seeing one live, right?
Mm.
The Sydney Opera House. I saw that motherfucker live. This they got this bridge in Sydney, Australia, man. You can walk on the rail on top of it. I wouldn't advise that for somebody with a weak stomach.
Does it move and sway?
Well, it doesn't sway. If you up high enough, you might want to. You don't want to look down. You're like, oh, but it's a beautiful view. It's a beautiful view. You walk on top of the railing, like, you know, like the bridge is here. You can walk on top of it.
Now, most of the population lives all by the water, all through Australia. I mean, the whole country.
The whole country. That tripped me out. Like I said, Perth was the first place, then Adelaide, then Sydney, and then Brisbane, I think I did. I enjoyed all of Australia.
I had a friend of mine who lived down there, who moved down there, and I had found out, and we started talking, and he says, dude, there's Italians down here. I says, well, did they put us in jail down there too? You know, because it was like a prison island. I said, what happened? Did we escape down there, or are we thrown down there? He says, no, it's like the south. It's like a little Italy down here. There's a whole section of Italians down there. I couldn't believe that there were Italians down there.
So is Malta. Dude, Malta has a gang of Italians.
Yeah, they all escaped from the mainland. Here's a question from Boogie.
Wait till you did. I still appreciate
it. You know, I really thought he was going to fall asleep after the dentist. He's still yapping.
Acid Overture, Boogie, you know what Acid Overture was. Acid Overture was my first attempt. It was my first attempt at trying to do a rock record for house music because it's cashmere. That's cashmere that Pete Black did. Because I asked him, because cashmere is one of my favorite songs from Led Zeppelin. And I wanted to do a house version of cashmere. Pete Black was like, okay, let's give it a try. And so he went down, he did it. I'm like, oh man, hell yeah. I'm not gonna call it motherfucking cashmere. I call that shit Acid Overture. Because you know, Rocky would put a 303 in. I'm like, a 303, this shit's gonna fuck it up, man. No. You know what I'm saying? Like, no. Anyway, Acid Overture is cashmere from Led Zeppelin. I know that's a little hidden secret, but
well, you know, in was it Diddy did it, and he did that remix for Godzilla. Remember the Godzilla remix in 98.
That's right. Yeah, exactly. And then when I heard him do it, I was like, okay, I'm gonna be quiet because I don't know who's listening to your show. So
Cashmere, them guys are recording out at the playground way out in the Heights years ago. Them guys are doing a lot of work at the, because I did some work out there, and they were like off of Route 30 and Western. And I think they were doing Past the Toilet Paper or some fucked up shit there one night. I come in there. Out in the Heights. They were recording out there early 90s.
What a tune. But they didn't fuck no Leds. I did. I stuck up Led Zeppelin twice.
Mm-hmm. I
stuck up twice. One for the TC crew. It was an album that DJ Ping and I did called Going All Out on the TC crew. Mm. Like, Boogie, I got a funny story about Wayne Gray. I wanted to do a hip-hop record. I know Rocky wasn't going to release no hip-hop record, but I was like, fuck it.
But
he would release freestyle. So I was like, well, if I got a chance to do one, and I'm going to produce this motherfucker, I'm make this the hardest record I could find. So I asked Mike Dunn, Fast Eddie, Taco Bops, and myself, and DJ Ping did the scratching, and we took Zep again. Same tune, man. Cash, man. Took it again. Fun times, man. That was, I always have fun doing hip-hop, and when it's not so, it's always, the music always serious, but when I don't have to play a part, I can just be me. Mm-hmm. And I mean, I'm not trying to release it for the masses, so to speak.
So with COVID and everything going on, all the shit going on, you know, a lot of, you know, I just read an article. Did you read about Paul Simon sold his whole catalog? The new thing now is everybody's selling their catalogs because their perception is, you know, at their age, their touring days are probably behind them. You know what I mean? And, you know, Paul Simon's age and, you know, well, whoever else is, you know, selling their catalogs. So do you, you were able to retain a lot of your catalog, correct? Were you able to retain it?
Yeah, you could say retain, or you could say I own it all.
You own it, right?
Yeah, I own it all. Everything from DJ International to Dance Mania, I still own my back catalog. Everything.
Good for you. No, have you thought about are you gonna remix? Do you still have the 2-inch masters, or because a lot of that stuff sometimes just disappears, man? It breaks your heart, yeah, right?
Well, during the court case with said record company. Mm-hmm.
The name that shall not be said.
Right. He said that all the recorded masters and 2-track masters were destroyed in a basement flood at the company. Mm-hmm. Whether it's true or not, I got to take him for his word, but I do know he cannot release it with nobody. No acapella, no 2-track. I even had one guy from, and I hate to say it, what was it? High Fashion Music. He worked at High Fashion Music. Remember High
Fashion Music? Netherlands, yeah.
Exactly. Yeah. I was stoked. He said, hey, man, I have your 2-tracks. I have a couple of your 2-track masters from.
Really?
From, what was that compilation? That big ass BCM compilation.
Yeah, that was that 16 CD history of house set. Yeah.
He said, hey, man, I have a couple of your 2-track masters. What you want to do? I'm like, send it to me. Mm-hmm. No, how much you willing to, how much, then he said, how much are you willing to pay for it? I said, you trying to extort me for my own music? Motherfucker, you cannot release it. So keep that shit, you can have it for a souvenir for all I care, because I'm not going to pay you for some shit that's mine, that someone else give you my money, but I mean, you know, you can have it. I was like, well, I got the vinyl. So as long as I got the vinyl, I still got the master.
And I've got the entire CD set sitting on my wall here with another 2,500 CDs. So you ever need, I've got all of your stuff on CD.
No.
Everything.
We might have to talk after this because I do need digital copy of some of that
stuff. You know what, Tyree? I started going digital when I started getting into the internet. We used to call it, remember, time to make the donuts. Remember the old Dunkin' Donuts commercial?
Yeah, hell yeah.
Where it was repetitive. The little old guy, get up. So when I was ripping my library starting in 96, 97, I have to rip, encode, FTP. That was it. Encode, rip the CD, encode the CD, and then FTP it to the servers.
Right.
So I could put it into the channels, because at one time I was programming 52 channels online. So I had all these different formats that I wound up programming, and that's all we did. So first we ripped the library to 128K WMA, and then we ripped it to 320 MP3, because it was just, we went from, and the reason why I was at WMA was because you had to compress files, and there wasn't really tremendous audio quality in 98, 99 on CD, nor would anybody have noticed a difference other than the fact that they were listening to music on the internet and it sounded great with their dial-up, you know what I mean, era. And the when I built the house channel for Sirius, Armando called me up, Rivera. Armando says, hey, they need somebody to program a house channel. So I'm like, oh, cool. Okay, I got all this stuff digital already, right? And, dude, I knew I couldn't just program Chicago stuff, so I made sure I had yours. You know, I had everything of yours. I had probably 400 total tracks for Sirius's original house channel about 2003. Mm-hmm. Then I had to throw the New York shit in there to keep them happy, to appease them. And but I didn't mind, because it was great stuff too. You know, I didn't mind, but I went, you know, I had to put Chicago stuff in there, because how do you have a house channel and not have Chicago house in it? You know what I mean? Come on. You know, it's like going to an Italian restaurant and they give you, you know, cottage cheese and peanut butter and call it macaroni. No, that's not the way it works. So we get this thing programmed, and guess what they did, Tyree? They said, yeah, you're going to program the channel. 8 months, they didn't do a thing to it. They call me in to fix the library. It was all screwed up. I get in there. I find out that everything was converted to a 96K WMA file. So they took all of the digital for the digital and converted it to 96K WMA. And this is around two. So there were Windows Media audio files, 96K. And that was what they were using at a lot of the channels at that time because they had this limited bandwidth going up to the bird. Right. So everything that was music oriented had to get compressed. So that's how I used to laugh. I said, what do you mean great audio quality? Dude, that sounds it's like AM stereo. It's shit. It's garbage. Nobody knew it at the time, though, because they were so enamored with the idea of satellite radio. And the channel lasted maybe a year. They dumped the channel. They just put my stuff on a loop, called it a day. And then once they did the merger, that was it.
And funny, you said Italy, right? One of my favorite parties been in Italy. I went to Venice, and I thought I was going to the old city, but I was going to the new city, and didn't know there was two cities. Mm. Like, there's an old Venice, and then there's a new Venice. So I'm like, okay, where the canal at? I want to see the canal, bro. Where the canal at?
Yeah.
Like, old city. I'm like, so what's the problem? Hey, Terry, you playing? I say, bro. I'm only here one night. Take me to the old city. That's the only few times I had to go, hey man, I'm Tyree Cooper in this motherfucker. I need to see some shit real quick. Mm-hmm. It's gonna be real quick. I just wanna see it. So I went to I saw the Venetian River in Venice, mm-hmm. the canal rather.
And the dudes with the Zoom shirts on. They had their Zoom shirts or the electric company shirts. The gondola dudes. Yeah.
And the gondola and shit and the gondola. Yeah. That shit is tripped out. And then when you buy the church, right, the big square, that's also scary because the motherfucking church is church is bouncing and shit. You're like, oh shit, this shit can go down.
Yeah, just when you think Florida's one big sinkhole, so is Venice.
I've only been to the airport in Rome and saw, and from the airport. From the airport, I could see the Pisa Tower. I haven't been in Rome, but I could see the Pisa Tower from the airport. Mm-hmm. I was called the Nipples, but it's Naples, which was fun. Sardinia. And then I went to Croatia, which I thought Croatia was far as fuck. I'm in the air, Sal, and it's a few times I had a weird moment. I'm in the air, I'm flying, I'm looking over, my mind is trying to figure out what set I'm gonna play in Serbia and stuff because I'm going to Serbia. I'm in Tony Kukoc land and shit, right? Mm-hmm. I'm thinking all Dino Raj, I'm thinking all the basketball players that play the NBA, my favorite. So as we flying over, I'm like, oh, I wonder what island is this that looks like a little boot at the end. Whatever, it's cool. Flew over it, coming back home. Oh yeah, there's the little island with the boot. I get home and I go, wait a minute. Hey, wait. Was that motherfucker? I was like, I asked my wife, is this Italy? She said, yeah, I thought so because I flew over the motherfucker with the little boot on it. And mm-hmm. in the air, I kid you not, Saul, it looks just like the picture, bro.
Yeah.
Man, listen. I've been on Italy's land. I've been to Parma where we get Parma meat and Parmesan cheese from. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. I've been to Milan. You know what I'm saying? I've been in Italy. Flying over the motherfucker, never. Flying into it, yeah. Flying over it. Man, when I saw that shit, I went, get the fuck. I said, hold up. If that's Italy and this Croatia, Then the world just opened up to me. This is the Balkans right here. All this is used to be. I've been to Bosnia. I've been to, you know what I'm saying? When I drove to Bosnia from Serbia, we drove through the countryside and you can still see the bullet holes and the tanks that are left in the fields.
Oh yeah, from war.
Yeah, from war, yeah.
Exactly. Macedonia, yeah.
Yeah, dude, I'm on the they have a toll road. They have a toll road for cars. When I tell you there's nobody on the street, bro, there's nobody on the street.
Mm.
They have a toll road. Three of them motherfuckers.
The Ultras, Ultra Spit is where there's, I hope that's how they pronounce it, how the Croatian. Yeah, they have some great festivals, some great EDM, you know. And there's another thing, you know, everybody wanted to pass up EDM here in Chicago. I was like, again, you guys are sleeping on what the rest of the world is doing. You know, you can't play Doctor's Cat, All Night Passion, and Yo-Yo Get Funky all day long. You have to understand that the rest of the world is also moving forward, and you need to move with it. And a lot of guys just weren't into that whole thing, man. You know, these EDM festivals, like you, because you live there, so you know, you saw this stuff. These are great things, man.
Hey, but Sal, that shit came hella late. EDM shit came hella late to Europe. While it was jumping off in America.
We were 2002, 2003, 2001 here for me. I already knew a dream house and everything. I was already doing that. But when it crossed over and exploded was about 2011, 2012 here. When it finally crossed over and it had mass saturation here for about 4 years. Right. And then it did the same thing disco did. You had guys like Deadmau5 who couldn't shut his fat fucking mouth. All he did is talk shit about the music and how it sucks. I'm like, dude, you're going to do the same thing that you let them do to disco. You're giving them the excuse to hang this shit up, ridicule it, and pummel it to death. And that's what they did. Every time he opened his mouth, you had these guys ridiculing the music. Yeah, some of it was bad, but every time he opened his mouth, he was like the doom and gloom. He was like that cloud of shit that followed that Charlie Brown character. What was the Charlie Brown character?
Pigpen.
He was like the cloud of doom every time he opened his mouth. This guy sucks. This guy sucks. Like, dude, you finally have a dance movement again in Chicago and in the U.S. where the music is above 100 beats per minute. And you're getting dance-oriented songs. And they killed the entire movement. And then COVID came along, so it's like, okay, now we got to wait another 2-3 years.
As I was saying, in Europe, right, it was so Johnny Come Lately that some of the stars, like your Benny Benassi's, your Deadmau5 or whatever, they had already had trance music careers in Europe, right? They couldn't come back to Europe. Very costing them. They couldn't come back to Europe with the same thing. They couldn't come back to Europe. So when it ended here, it ended it for them everywhere else.
And Ferry's a great guy, Tyree. I don't know if you ever worked with him, but I interviewed him, man. Another guy. He knew all the Chicago stuff. Every one of these guys that I met from Europe, all right, respected all the stuff that happened here, and they knew their New York shit. They were very respectable about what everybody did here. Doors open, arms open. And there was a time where I would see guys say, screw the year, screw it. I'm like, man, do you understand these guys actually show you love and show you props and invite you out there? And
they don't know it, because when the story gets told, this is them. This is what they're presenting now. If they did interviews, some of them may not even mention Farley's or Tyree's or Fast Eddie's or Mike Dunn's. Well, these cats, they so stuck on that they're now famous and famous in America, not just in Europe, but they're famous in America.
Mm-hmm.
That's their ultimate goal, because they took what the Europeans did for us in Europe, they now did for the Europeans in America.
In America, right. Right.
So they took the exact same format, same promotion style, but they did it for the artists here. And there's a lot of bad things I didn't like about EDM, but the one thing I can't give EDM credit for that house music did, it put on everybody. EDM kept it kept the race relations to one race. House music, you had Spanish. You had black, you had white, Yeah, everybody in one room or two rooms or three rooms in the 20-year period, everybody was getting down. It wasn't just, you know, this is what we doing and boom, boom, boom. No, it was everybody getting down. EDM didn't do that. They kept it they kept it culturally
biased. White. Well, because don't forget, you know, Europe, you know, that culturally majority of the countries are white. So
yeah, but that's what I'm saying. The thing is, in Europe, it was only about the integration of the black artists from America or the Latin artists from America or the white artists from America intertwining, or I'm just gonna be straight with it.
Go ahead.
Europeans was they was happy stealing from us.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they was happy taking it from us. When the switch came, when the Europeans went over to America, they took what Europe did and bring it to America. So these, like Dirty Like Vegas, they were a small ragtime band, and they got bigger in America. They weren't that big in Europe, and nowhere in Europe. Now, you know, Ferry Corsten had a career, but it was doing under trance, not under EDM. Benny Benassi, another one, and a few other ones, right? They were all under the trans umbrella, not EDM. But when they came to America, because they had names already in Europe, they could sell them because the magazines in America was already talking about these cats 1 to 2 years prior to, just like it was in America. But when the British brought us over, or brought the American artists over, the setup was different. The setup was, he was in this magazine, that magazine. When they brought the European artists over to America, we talking about Rolling Stones and every other major magazine writing about this music that you had already known about, Sal, before they got there, because it wasn't nothing new that they were doing. It just louder, had a little more heavier bass sound to it, right? Again, they took the exact same thing the brothers was doing in Europe. They just whited it out for American audience.
Yeah. Go ahead.
I think I was gonna say, like, here they got the EDC, Electric Daisy Chain.
Carnival. Yeah, the EDC.
Chain.
Electric Daisy. Yeah.
Electric Daisy Carnival. Right. It's an EDM event.
Mm-hmm.
And when I first got here in Vegas, man, it looked like a teenage invasion. Because all these kids running around everywhere, and the party is in a drag. What is that? Where they have drag races at, right?
Yeah, and yeah, they had the same one here when they had EDC here in Chicago in 2015. They did it at Joliet Speedway.
Yeah, they did. Okay. The same thing here then. So it's humongous. I mean, it's humongous. And even with the COVID, they did the EDC virtual. They had you know, the fire in the background of the DJs and all this kind of stuff in the background and stuff. So they kept it a buck for that scene. But
from what I remember, one of the guys that runs Ultra is from Chicago. I can't remember his name. It'll come to me one day. But the guy who runs Ultra,
he's called Pat. What's his name?
That sounds familiar. I think you're right.
I almost did a deal with Ultra. Almost.
Mm-hmm.
Almost.
Well, were the terms not favorable to you, or you just couldn't come to an agreement? Because they've got, I mean, they're distributed digitally. That's where all the money's at for them. So,
the thing was with me with Ultra was I wanted more money. I wanted more money because my hubris. I said, look, my catalog is thick. You're gonna make your money back with my catalog.
Mm-hmm.
They was telling me, "Nah, we not for sure." I'm going, okay. And I wasn't asking for $1.5 million. I was just asking enough so I can eat and pay some bills and shit.
Mm-hmm.
And so we couldn't come to an agreement. I never hold anything against Ultra or nothing like that. It's just we just couldn't come to an agreement where I know once I put my back catalog up, it's gonna make his money because there's too many people asking for it. And
why don't you remix this stuff, bro? Get it remixed and just keep. You have the power now. You know that. Yeah. You have the power between any digital format to control all of your revenue.
Right. That's the thing. I don't want to necessarily do it digitally because, you know, the next thing that's coming up is the exact same thing these kids missed is vinyl.
You know, yeah, there's only, Tyree,
I love you,
but I think there's only going to be so much in vinyl. Although you can probably get a nice penny for some of these, especially if you do some of these NFT or whatever. What's that shit?
Non-fungible.
Yes.
Fungible token.
Yeah. Yes. That's a different story. That's a whole different market.
No, but Sal, listen, man. I'm in Europe. When let's say, what's this group? My Wonderwall, Oasis. When they drop a song now, just for hypothetically speaking, the major labels 20 years ago used to say, okay, CD and digital. Because digital was kind of new. 10 years after that, it was just digital. 5 years after that, it's only digital. 5 years later, they got, because I'm going to trip you out. We talking now they're selling cassettes, CDs, vinyl, and MP3s.
Yeah.
So because this generation of young kids missed it. I missed about 10 parties because I refused to take vinyl to a party because I lived on the fourth floor and I'm not 22 no more. Mm. When I say the fourth floor, I really mean the fifth floor because Germany, their buildings aren't, some of the places don't have elevators, so I have to walk with a record bag. I'm not doing that shit. Mm. But they only have vinyl parties. Only vinyl parties. So it's not a matter of if it's a new vinyl, if it's a new track or a new artist. If it's fucking on, bro, some shit they play, they go, hey, this was back in the day. I was like, yeah, it probably is, but we still wanna fuck with it. Like, no, I'm like, dude.
What do you mean? It's Hobble Globble Tribbin by Bernard Wright. It's the greatest song ever. Ever.
I'm like, this song still sucks, bro. I like it because it's old. I'm like, so they really, my point is, they really thirsty for vinyl. And what's this, 21? So the vinyl craze started about 2013 and 2014.
So we did a report on it in 2015 when they were creeping.
And it's only getting better because the thing is, Sal, I know I got a lot of people listening, and I'm gonna be quiet on this real quick. You're not making money from digital, so they're finding other ways to make money. So certain record companies or certain independent record companies are really, really investing in vinyl. I mean, I'm talking like there's two new pressing plants that opened up in Europe when there were not no more. Mm-hmm. France was the only one, and the cheapest one in all of Europe was in the east side of Germany. Now there's about 7 or 8 pressing plants when there was none, or lack thereof. So I'm saying, my point is, we're past the days of going to the record store and buying vinyl, but these young kids now, that's what they living for. And cassettes, dude, fucking the cassette has made a comeback, Sal. I can still remember taking a pencil and screwing in the tight wind the tape. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
CDs ain't really came back so much because they wore it out, but vinyl and cassettes are making a comeback at a serious rate because
they always say what goes around comes around. And I can honestly tell you that I will not be shitting in my pants ever again. I'm not going that far back into old school. All right. I care about the vinyl. There's just certain things that we don't need to be revisiting.
I say the same thing. But that's what I'm waiting. That's what I'm desperate to do. I'm going to release my stuff on vinyl. I have a I let this cat out the bag. My brother's Rub sound system. Urban, I call him Herb. I keep calling him Herb. DJ Urban. Him and his partner remixed Turn Up the Bass. I have a remix of Turn Up the Bass. So my point is, once this vinyl, once this COVID thing has kind of subsided a little bit more, I'm going to release that as a vinyl, the remix of Turn Up the Bass. I re-released Acid Over on vinyl. Most of my older hip house records, I will be releasing on vinyl. Like the newer stuff, yeah, I probably do digital with it, but like my classic stuff, I'm probably gonna do on vinyl. So and with extra mixes or extra edit.
Oh, you're locked up over there. Yeah, you're locked up. Look, we even get technical difficulties on the internet. Hang on, can you still hear me? I don't know. While we're waiting for whatever this digital glitch is, we're sitting with Tyree Cooper here on the Back in the Day show. And for those of you watching the show, maybe you're coming in late, don't worry about it. We're going to have the show. They're all on demand, and all you got to do is go to the... Are you there?
There we go.
You're back? Okay. Yeah, so Tyree's back, so I will tell you once again, you can watch the entire show. We have an archive. Go to thebeatchicago.com's website, Back in the Day section, search keyword Back in the Day. And don't forget, Tyree Cooper's links, we'll have them all on the on-demand version, so you can hook up with Tyree on his SoundCloud, his Facebook page.
There we go, now we're back.
All right, you back there? You're frozen. Right now, I just got you frozen.
Yeah, now we're back.
Okay. I don't know. Move around. Shake your hand. Woo!
Right. Nope, we're not back yet.
All right, now we're back. Now you're back.
Can you Boogie, hear me? That wasn't it. Yeah, Boogie
asked. He'll come back in. And while, he'll come right back in. He'll get back in there. All right, hang on. You there? You're back. Oh, now you're good.
Because Boogie asked the question. Boogie, that wasn't for the UK. Okay, here's another story, Sal, real quick. So.
Wait till I get my hands on Comcast. Oh. You're breaking up. Tyree. Log in, log back out again. See if that helps you. Oh, you're back? Yeah, because you're still frozen. Back? Yeah, you're frozen on the screen. I hear you saying back. And what I wanted to do here we go. I'm going to pull this up. Once we come back, when Tyree gets back, we'll come right back. I'm going to split the screen for you here. When you go to the beachchicago.com's website, go to the back. There's where you find the old shows, all shows right
there
here.
There we go.
You're there back, go. Larry?
Okay. Yeah, here we go.
All right. So bring you back. Boogie asked
about, okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Boogie asked about this trip. So we were doing a show. We had a show booked for Newport Beach, Virginia, right? And so everything is fine. We get on an airplane, Cool Rock Steady, myself, and Benji. So we get on the plane, and you know, the plan.
This is a communist plot, I'm telling you. They're trying to kill house music.
And it takes off.
You're bouncing in and out again, Tyree. Can you still hear me? While we're waiting for Tyree here, I'm going to do this on the screen. And don't forget digitalsaverschicago.com for those of you who have old VHS tapes, movies, mixtapes. Maybe you got married two or three times. You're bound to have one of them weddings you want to remember. We can transfer them all to digital. So they'll last a lifetime. It's digitalsaverschicago.com. 815-556-2685. Oh, my God. I am getting so good at ad-libbing all this. Tyree's going to come back in here. I just saw him push in, push out here. So he'll come back here. We're getting to a story where Boogie had talked about Boogeyman. There's a story with him, Benji, going to the UK, and Boogie got a little confused. He just got back from the dentist today, so those drugs are kicking in. Tyree will figure it out and get it straight as soon as he comes back in. But, you know, when you talk about Tyree's, you know, Turn Up the Bass was huge, right? And it was a Cool Rock who did the rap on that. God rest his soul, man. He was a wonderful spirit to work with, Cool Rock. And I had a chance to work with Cool Rock and some, you know, and it was the track itself was did very well. We had licensed it overseas. You're back? You're good?
Yes, there you go.
Yeah, okay. There you go. So go ahead.
Hopefully I can get the story in.
Yeah.
Okay, so we had a booking in Newport News in Virginia. So we get on the airplane, the plane ascends, and we make that turn, and then all of a sudden the fucking engine falls.
The engine fell while you were on the plane. And now we're locked up again. That's where you locked up again, but we got you right at falls. So when you come back in, pick it up from falls. We're doing our own digital editing right now. This is great. Digital editing.
Okay.
Let me know when you come back in here. Let me switch this back here because I can see you. It's just you're frozen right now. So just let me know you're back in the mix, as Boogie would say. Want to bring you up the little trick. This was Cool Rock on a track, and we're waiting for Tyree Cooper to come back in. Tyree will come back in here to finish this story, I'm hoping. I'm sure he will. But what you may not have heard, this was Cool Rock when it was huge in Germany. Where are we licensed? Germany, Italy, Japan, Singapore, Pan, what do you call the Pan Asian? So whatever that is. Get to the Cool Rock part. There you go. Sorry, you back? You back?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Go ahead. So the engine fell off.
So the engine fell off, and you keep hearing Benji go, oh, shit, oh, fuck, oh, fuck, oh, fuck. And so the pilot lands the plane, and this one woman, and the entire time he's trying to land the plane,
locked up again. That's weird. I'm checking my speeder. No, I'm good. I'm good on my end here. I'm at a full gig connect. I got a gig connection here. I wonder where the backup is, Tyree. Well, he'll come back and we'll finish this story. It's a two-minute story that's being dragged out with no commercials for 18 minutes. So this is kind of cool. Are you there still? You're good? All right, we'll go back to Cool Rock real quick. And this was actually done after Turn Up the Bass. I think
we're not going.
You there? You there? Okay, let me come back to this.
I'm not no
cinnamon. Yeah, it's like there's my mother. And then we had Cool Rock do the rap. And before 20 Fingers, it was JJ Flores that I put in the studio with Omar Santana. A lot of you may remember Omar from a lot of the freestyle records, Omar. And Omar is doing a lot of hardcore techno stuff now. He's still running his game, still making things happen. And JJ's out in L.A., him and was it Steve? I think they worked together on some things, a couple hits in 2016. But when we put JJ in the studio at that time, I think he was just coming off a record he produced for Onofrio. Yeah. I know it's been a long time, right, Chris? We're sitting there waiting for Tyree to get the connection back. It's been a long time, Chris. All right, Tyree, you back?
Yeah, I'm back.
Boogie says too many windows open. No, actually, I'm down to four windows now, so I'm good. With 32 gigs of RAM, I'm good. So go ahead, man. Finish your story.
So what happened was when the lady kept saying, we're going to die, Kool Rock said, bitch, we're not going to die. So we landed.
Said it just like that, right? He said, bitch, we ain't going to die.
Bitch, we ain't going to die. And so he landed the plane. So the pilot landed the plane. So the lady gets out. They said, we're going to die. She gets out. She kisses the tarmac. And so we like, all right, cool. But how the fuck we going to get to Virginia now? They said, you got to book another flight. So we get, that was Piedmont. Then we had another flight. American Airlines switched us over. So American was like, nope, we have engine trouble too. So we can't fly. So we stood in the airport. Now, I didn't know none of the, you know, we got interviewed. Benji got interviewed. Kool Rock got interviewed. Ain't nobody talk to me about shit. And that's just Chicago. So
oh, that's a bummer. Hey, that's the one thing about technology. It's a double-edged sword. Tyree, you're still coming in and he's gonna bounce in, bounce out again. It's one thing about technology. Chris, you're watching, right? It's like having a 9600 baud dial-up, ain't it, when that shit happens? My God, you know, back in the day before everybody had high-speed internet access, we had dial-up. And I think the first time I had dial-up, I want to talk, was 88. I think we were at 2400 baud. And that's what they used to call it, baud. And now the speeds that we have in the house, what happens is a lot of people don't understand, you know, when you get these buffering issues, it's not necessarily him or us. A lot of times it's they have these connections. It's very geeky, but, you know, there might be an issue in a node somewhere in the connection. It might be 36 hops to get from him to here. You know, you try and explain, internet stuff, you know, I'm way out, geeked out beyond belief, but Tyree, you're back, so thank God I don't have to talk geek shit no more.
So no, that's fine. No, it's fine. I believe. So we get there. We get to everybody's interviewing us. All that shit went down. We do the show in Newport News. Get back to Chicago. Everybody gets a free flight in the continental United States except for me.
Why? Did they not like your shoes?
The flights were booked in my name. Benji got two flight tickets. Yaya got two flight tickets. Kool Rock got two flight tickets. Fucking Lauren got two free flight tickets. I did not get one. I couldn't.
So you're never flying. So needless to say, you will not be flying your airline any longer.
Oh, no. Piedmont is not an airline anymore.
No, that's right. Because they were East Coast, right? Appalachians, they were an East Coast airline, right? Yeah.
That was remember. Who else? I didn't have to worry about TWA.
Yeah, we're gonna lock it. We're gonna keep locking it up here. I'm so bummed. Can you still hear me, Tyree? Because I think, you know what we're gonna do is we're gonna wrap it up here. But I'm gonna wait for you to come back in so we can wrap it up properly. Because you locked, you're frozen up again. And again, if you're just joining the show and you missed the early part of the show, talking with house music legend Tyree Cooper. You can watch the on-demand version of the show once we get it back up. You can find it in the you go to thebeatchicago.com right here. This is one of our web properties. Beat Chicago and all the shows are on demand. You're back, Tyree. Hey, Tyree, have you been to the Beach website? You've ever been to our website?
No.
Yeah. See, I mean, it's like Herb Kent all day. It's all okay, classic R&B.
DJs too, man.
It's classic R&B and Blue Eyed Soul mostly. You know what I mean? So you're gonna hear that's what's playing right now. I mean, you know, Third World. You know, nobody plays this stuff anymore. So that's why we play all the classic R&B on the beat, and then on the weekends, it's the mixes, and of course, your stuff is always on. You know, on Saturday night, we do the Saturday Night Live Ain't No Jive Chicago Dance Party. And then Fridays, we do the old show, the old school stuff, too. But on Fridays, we do mostly 90s and 2000s. You know what I mean? And then on Saturdays, it's just full blown Rush Street, Mendel, you know, Chic Rick, Lamarant. It's all old school house on Saturday nights. So Tyree Cooper is our guest.
Okay.
Tyree, can you hear me now? Because I can see you moving, and I'm just trying to fill in time so you can come back in. Boogie.
Yeah.
Boogie's still, you know, honestly, God, he told me earlier, here's the deal, Tyree. I call him, see how he's doing. Well, he texts me. He says a few nasty things to me. I tell him that he looks nice in a tutu. And then he went to the dentist. And I said, okay, well, then you probably won't be able to check out the show. And he come off. No, go to sleep. And he's still up. You know, and he's not watching for me. He's watching for you.
That's my I tell you, man. We went to New York together, right? I know we're gonna laugh when I tell this story. We went to New York together. It was Martin, myself, Eddie, two young brothers, I think. Now we had told the two young brothers, hey man, you gotta be cool because this is New York. They're fucking around. This is not the new New York nowadays. This is the New York from back in the day. Mm-hmm. Or like, you know, going down on 40 Deuce, you down on 40 Deuce or 43rd, anywhere down in that area, it was like New Jack City. So we was at the Midtown, right? We was at the Midtown Hotel. So we telling them, hey man, be careful. Don't be running out. Oh man, it's New York. We got this. We know what's going on. As you know, we came back, my man Pocket was ripped all off his ass. Mm. Like, what happened? They tried to rob us, man. They tried to steal my wallet. Like, wait, what? Yeah, man, they tried to steal my wallet. He's like, we tried to tell you, fool. This is New York. Yeah, at the red zone. That's right. Mm. Red zone. We tried to tell you, fool. This is New York. You cannot play in New York. This is the city. This is not Chicago. This is not like, hey, man, you know, you say one or two words, you know. And he was huffing and puffing. Funny, very funny. For Boogie, the Palladium, I was going to say something different. Not the Palladium, Boogie. I was going to say the Red Zone, because when they heard when Boogie played in the mix, yeah, no, we didn't hang out with Run DMC. That motherfucker was drunk.
Tyree, we got to come back and do a part two, bro.
He was drunk.
Yeah, we got to come back and do a part two when the connection. We've been going for over two. Dude, I didn't last this long in my first sexual experience. We've gone for a long time tonight. So we've gone for a while, but we got to come back and do a part two. We definitely do, because the connection keeps going in and out. I'm very bummed. Can you still hear me? Yeah, see, you locked up.
Yeah. David Rice played in the mix, but remember when you heard it, when we heard it, it was like a fucking a concert and shit, right?
Can you hear me? You can hear me, right? Can you hear me?
It was like a fucking concert.
Yeah. Tyree, can you hear me, bro?
If you can hear me, Boogie, give me a thumbs up.
Yeah. You can't hear me, though, can you? Can you hear me? Look, the networks do stuff like this and nobody tunes out. It's okay. So here's what we're going to do. Hopefully Tyree will come in and then come back out. And this is really, really cool, too, about this program. I can talk to him in text. So we're going to definitely come back and do it. Tyree, you're there now because now you moved, so I can hear you. Did you hear me? Yeah, we're getting intermittent. So next week, next Monday, which is the 12th here on Earth, Farley, Jackmaster Funk, Farley, Funkin, Keith, Richards, and whatever else he named himself along the way, Farley's going to join us next week, and that's going to be a lot of fun. Tyree, can you hear me? Because I can hear your water. Let me try this here. And then back in. Can you hear me?
There we go. There we go.
Yeah. I removed myself and pulled myself. I was just saying, you know, we're definitely going to have to do a part two, man, because the last 20 minutes have been a little, there's been a little gremlin in there. But what I was saying is next week, Farley's going to join me next week. I got Farley on next week.
Hey, tag me in that, because that's my big brother, man. That's my big brother, because Farley, Jackmaster Funk, used to hang up the phone I called him. Because back in the day, you know, he used to put the telephone number on the bottom of the record, right?
Mm.
So in case, you know, for distribution or whatever.
Distribution, right.
Right. So I'm thinking this is a record company. I thought Farley's record, House Records, was a normal record company. Didn't know I was actually talking to Farley, right? I'd be like, hey, man, I'm Tyree Cooper, man. I'm on WNUR, and I'm, you know, I love your record. I want to play it. You know, I want to be able to play it. So is it possible to get free copies? I could imagine Farley looking at the phone, man. I'm like, dude, don't call me no more, man. don't call me no more. Just don't. To the point where that's my big brother. That's Farley has, again, he extended his hand and said, I got you. To me, been my biggest influence, my biggest aspiration to date.
I'm gonna make sure we bring you in next week. I'll send you the invite because once I schedule the show,
I'm all day.
I'll schedule the show with Farley, and I'll send you the invite, and that'll be next Monday. Same bat time, same bat channel with Farley, Jackmaster Funk, and you together. Oh, God. We'll have Farley sing Daryl Pandy's parts, and you can sing, I don't know, Forever or More. You know, together, we'll do a mashup. It'll be fun. We'll do freestyle and hip-hop. And I know you probably can't hear a word I'm saying, can you?
Yeah.
So, can you hear me?
Say what you want to say. Yes. We got the green light.
We're gonna call it a night. Hey, Tyree, it was great, bro. Yeah. This was a lot of fun, man. It's a lot of fun.
My brother.
And we had a lot of great people checking.
And always, Sal, you my brother, bro. Always.
Right back at you. And I'll send you that invite for Farley for next week. It'll be a good time, man.
All right, brother.
Say goodbye. Say goodnight, Gracie.
Good night, Gracie.
Have a good week. I'll talk to you soon. All
right. Yes, sir. Yes.
All right, bro.
All right.
Good night.
All right. Oh, man. Peace, man.
Yep.